I'll give you a quick run through of Darman video right now. Hi, I am cheating wife. Hi, I am husband with failing business. Damn, you're so gross. I'm gonna cheat on you. She cheats. My business is now succeeding. Cheating wife wants to come back and sleep with him again. But he's like, no, I'm successful now. Moral of the story, don't cheat on your husband.
And then everyone claps.
Yeah. Welcome to Trash Taste Podcast. This is the most... recent episode you'll ever experience on Trash Taste, I think.
This is the first time, I think, since we started that we used the entirety of our backlog.
Yeah.
So we can talk about topics that happened literally just last week as this is airing.
Whoa!
Right now.
Which I actually do want to.
Timely.
But I did see a thing. They were like, please, can you start talking about more recent topics? It's so annoying hearing it like 4 weeks later. I don't know. I like the fact that we get to like sit on it a little bit and we get to talk about it and it comes out later.
Because so much happens or so much changes, right? Especially if it just happened. Like, you know, something might happen where it completely changes our opinions or situations.
Yeah.
And then we just look like idiots. It's just poorly aged.
Yeah, I mean, videos, right? I mean, I think it just works well for us as well because it just proves that, you know, we don't have to talk about current topics to get people to watch us, hopefully.
By the way, do you want to introduce ourselves?
What do you mean? We're the boys.
We're the boys.
We really just like went right into it. But it's
we're
like,
the boys. That's it.
Hello, yeah, this is like episode 2 of season 2. You know who we are. You know who we are, obviously.
I think episode 54 was like 5 weeks ahead. And then the episode after that was just 1 week ahead. So it's like, it's kind of, it's interesting. But I do like the fact that, I mean, the way we record it is because that's how we like to do it, right?
Yeah.
We like to have the backlog so that we always give you an episode weekly. And we don't really give a shit about trending topics most of the time. I think we want to just talk anyway.
Most trending topics just don't mean anything to us.
Yeah. And even then I feel like, you know, we don't really go that deeply into it. You know, we're not doing a 2-hour deep dive on the newest scandal. We just kind of mention it in passing like, oh, that was a shitty thing.
Right.
Which is what I will be talking about today.
I mean, how can you when it literally just happened and you have so little information to work off, right?
Yeah. And also I feel like we're not like a drama channel.
If you want
the hot scoops, the hot takes, it's not from us.
No.
We have hot takes about fucking food and all other shit.
We have hot takes about like non-timely topics.
But speaking of hot topics, there is one that came up recently that I thought was just so incredibly fucking stupid that I do want to talk about it.
Go on.
Okay. I tweeted about it yesterday as well.
Oh.
That was the crypto scam by like the FaZe clan.
I tweeted about that yesterday as well.
I'm not being funny. If you believe in any financial advice from someone from the FaZe clan, you have to start questioning what's going on. But I know most of these kids are not. I don't think most of them are young. Because how the fuck do they have crypto wallets? I'm 25.
Okay. Very naive parents.
I am out the loop. Can you explain to me what
that
I
is
missed?
Right, gone. Of course. So, FaZe Clan, which if you don't know, are an absolutely massive organization on YouTube.
Yes.
They have members that. I cannot distinguish to save my life. They all sound feel very familiar in my head.
There's also like 70 of them.
I don't know how many there is. There's about like, I think there's less than 10 of them. They're all massive.
No, right? There's more than 10.
Is there?
There has to be.
I just know that they are gamers.
They're gamers. So yeah, they're mainly gamers. They mainly do, you know, very clickbait videos. A lot of them cover very hot games. So like when it's Fortnite, they're Fortnite, you know, and then they kind of pick up the biggest creators. Yeah. Most of them have over like 5 million subs. So most of them have over 10 million subs.
Yeah.
And a few of them have recently started, advertising cryptocurrencies.
And, I like where this is going.
Yeah.
This seems to have been a concerning topic with influencers in general recently where they've been, you know, I don't mind you talking about your crypto investments and whatnot, but there's a difference between that and being like, hey, invest in whatever. So there was the big scandal this time was that there was a coin called like Save the Kids Foundation.
Right.
It's literally called like, this is like a parody. Like this is what like a parody movie would call this scam, Save the Kids, you know what I mean?
Yeah.
And they had like all of, they had this like flashy promotional video where all of them were like, I'm here to save the kids. Like all the FaZe Clan members like, I'm holding to save the kids. And so they advertised this coin that they also like had someone who helped them develop it. So they were in from the start developing this coin, making it. So they had all the coin before it even went live.
Mm-hmm.
And if you don't know how cryptocurrency works, I'm not gonna explain it.
There's videos on YouTube.
Frankly, I don't know.
Yeah.
All I know is that they had the money before, they had access to this marketplace before anyone did. They already had all the money. They promoted the fuck out of it. I mean, it's typically called a pump and dump, right? So you promote the shit out of it, the value goes up.
And then you sell
and then
off
they
your-
sold. They sold all of their coin immediately. So when this coin went up in value and it went immediately to shit.
Yeah. Like there's actually graphs of it that you can see where it's like day one, it's like up here and then it just goes.
Yeah. So I think it started off like one penny it was worth.
Yeah.
these coins. And then it was, well, I think now it's worth less than a hundredth of a penny.
I think it's like a thousandth of a penny. Yeah, it's even less it's than ridiculous. That.
Yeah. It feels like that should be illegal.
I think.
If you did stuff like this in the stock market, it would be very illegal.
Yeah, that's like some Wolf of Wall Street shit, right?
But then I feel like I'm just the guy watching the shit show that is crypto. I don't really give a shit about getting into crypto, but I love keeping up with it and love seeing the drama. Mm. And they're always just at each other's throat on whether they want regulation or not.
Yeah.
And so that's the debate of, should it be regulated to stop shit like this from happening? Mm. But even then, I think if the FEC, I think that's what it is, wanted to investigate, I think they could arrest them. And someone actually found their wallets, crypto wallets, which is unique to the person who buys or sells a crypto. You can only have one, or you can have more than one wallet. It's a unique thing that everyone can see because crypto is public. And so people managed to find the FaZe Clan's wallets and saw that at least one of them, a bunch of them all sold immediately, which shows that they kind of had some malicious intent.
Mm. Yeah.
And one of them had done like four of these schemes and sold immediately every single time. And bear in mind, if this was four, you know, these people have like 10 million subs. So their income is probably already over, you know, seven figures a year.
Yeah.
Right. And so they're doing these, I mean, they're just scams. That's blatantly what they are.
I mean, these like, are just...
Call it what it is. It's a fucking scam.
It is a scam.
They're running these scams that could easily put them in jail. And some of them only made like 50 grand. And don't get me wrong, 50 grand is a lot of money. It's a lot of money.
But in retrospect of how much they're already probably making.
Bro, if they did a raid fucking Shadow Legends, they'd get 100K. Are you kidding me? Why are they risking their life for 50K?
That's not a lot. In the grand scheme of things, for the amount that they're making, for what they're putting on the line as well. That's like going into tax evasion to like save a tenner or something like that. Like what the fuck are they doing?
At least when you rob people, you can wear a ski mask.
Yeah, right.
They're fucking promoting it publicly, and then their fucking wallets are public.
I thought they were like making millions. That's what it sounded like.
So elaborate and so like crazy that I was like, these guys must be getting millions from this. No, they made like 60K, and it's like what. You guys are so fucking dumb. This is the dumbest thing I've seen. Like, at least with the fucking, the whole T. Martin CSGO gambling thing.
Yeah, because that's what he reminded me of.
Yeah, at least he was probably making millions.
Easily.
If you're going to like risk your life, at least, like that's what pissed me off the most about this. I'm like, you guys are so fucking dumb. I couldn't believe this, like when I saw it.
Just upload a couple of vlogs, just add a shitload of minerals on you, you probably make the same amount.
Yeah. It's just, I've watched channels that like are dedicated to finding these like crypto scams, and there's so many YouTubers doing this. It's so appalling. It's so sad.
It's pretty fucked. Like the more like I've seen people reacting to it, I've just never looked into what was going on myself. Yeah. It just seems like, very much like the CSO skin get scam, right? Yeah. Whatever, I forget what that scam was called.
Kind of like that, but at least gambling, you know, there's something there. You just lose with it. You just get scammed.
At least
like,
you get skins.
Maybe you like, get you a butterfly knife, I don't know. Like,
you don't get anything with this crypto shit. So, yeah, I don't know, man. It's like, and there was a bunch of other YouTubers who were doing it too, right? Like,
quite a lot.
I think like, I mean, RiceGum, I think was involved in the FaZe thing as well.
RiceGum is in FaZe Clan.
Yeah. He was in FaZe Clan. So he was part of the campaign as well.
Sam Pepper is apparently, do you remember Sam Pepper? Sam Pepper is a very well-known prank channel, and he was canceled a while back. Yeah. And of course, he is known. He's very popular right now because he's doing crypto scams.
Are we just going through like the fucking top 10 list of YouTuber scumbags? That's literally what it sounds like.
YouTube scumbag? They're literally doing this crypto
Logan Paul was doing it as well,
Logan Paul was pushing this shit.
Of course he was.
I've never been one for like, you should lose your platform for stuff, but I genuinely think if you're doing this shit, you shouldn't be allowed on YouTube.
Well, of course.
How YouTube lets like people who do this shit, like still upload like, and like, yeah. it, cause it, it's, you know, we already have a bad enough rep as YouTubers.
Yeah.
We already have like one of the worst reps of any reps. The last thing we need is every single person over 10 million subs fucking shilling garbage crypto that is blatantly a scam.
And it's so shitty as well, right? Because like internet personalities are like built on like a trust, right? Of like, I love this content creator.
Who's trusting
these
guys?
You know, I love these people.
What I want to know is how they're getting away with this shit. How?
There's no regulation on it.
Yeah.
And
like, you know, as much as, you know, a lot of people don't want websites to get involved, rightfully so, because YouTube and Twitter, where they normally try and enforce shit, it's a fucking mess.
Yeah.
So it's kind of this thing of like, Well, maybe there should be exceptions when they're notably being scumbags.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I don't even know if what they're doing is illegal, but I assume if it is illegal, then that is like a genuine reason to deplatform them.
It definitely
them.
Feels illegal.
It definitely feels illegal. This definitely shouldn't feel illegal, whatever they're doing.
Like, that's literally like being like, yeah, I'll give you $10. JK, it's 10 cents. You know, it's literally that.
I just don't understand what sick fuck like builds up this audience, right? And then just is like, all right, I'm just going to take their money. Like,
that's what's the shitty thing, right? It's like, it's built on a trust system. Yeah. Your viewers trust you as a personality. They'll listen to anything you say, right? Being like, oh, well, if my favorite content creator says I should do this, I should probably do this. And so I feel that it works both ways, right? It's like, obviously influencers are kind of fucked in a sense because they're literally taking advantage of a fan base that trusts them. But at the same time, the viewers aren't really thinking for themselves, right? They're not thinking like, this might be a scam.
It's hard, right? Because you do, like, it's unfortunate. People do build up trust. Yeah. Like, for some reason, they trusted someone with the name FaZe in front of their name.
Why?
You know, it's sad, man. I just, the idea of someone like looking up to this person plays Fortnite or whatever.
Yeah.
We clearly are very knowledgeable about what FaZe Clan does.
You know, and
this is the most gamer one out of us three, and even he's having trouble describing them.
It's that side of gaming that is blatantly marketed towards, you know, under 16-year-olds.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not really into that.
Yeah.
You know, and it's sad. It's just really sad. I just don't understand how you could go to a meet and greet ever and look your fans in the eye and be like, I'm so glad to meet you. It's like, no, you're fucking
thank
not.
You for changing
that
my life.
That man's a fucking wallet when you meet them. You know what I mean? Like, it's one thing to like e-beg in various ways, but like, I think this is just like
a point. E-steal, isn't it?
Yeah. You're just stealing.
Because like, what blows my mind hearing the story is that there are so many legitimate ways to make money that is not this shady. I mean, fuck, you know, like how much did Logan Paul and Jake Paul make from like a fucking boxing match, right?
Mm. That's what blows my mind is that Logan Paul must have made what, $20, $30 million from that fight? And then he's here promoting Dink Donk coin or Ding, whatever it is, fucking
some
coin.
Some dumbass fucking name, like, yeah.
What are you doing, man? You're already fucking rich as shit. Do you really need to do this?
Yeah,
like, this is what blows my mind. I don't understand.
Because like, I've thought that, you know, as much as they are scumbags and everything, they're also like fucking geniuses for being able to monetize how fucking hated they are because they've made millions from doing boxing matches. So I'm just like, well, okay, that was pretty clever. I'll give you the rep for, you know, monetizing your
at least you're putting your body on the line.
Yeah,
right?
Monetizing you being a scumbag. But then there's just this, which is, you know, it's not nowhere near as profitable as getting punched in the face. And I'd much rather get punched in the face, thank you very much. honestly.
Jeez.
If I had the options to get punched in the face or do the sponsorship, I'd be like, just punch me in the face every time.
Do I get paid the same amount?
Yeah, same
amount. I'll recover.
It's like the would you rather, right? Would you rather get punched in the face for $20 million or scam people out of crypto for $50,000?
Or do an illegal act. Which would you rather do?
It's sad. The whole thing is so sad. Every time I think, oh yeah, YouTube is a lot of them are pretty bad, huh?
And guaranteed as well, like when this does break out into like the mainstream, if it hasn't fucking already, like news outlets are going to pick it up. They're going to be like, these YouTubers are doing blah, blah, blah. And you know, what sucks is that, yeah, there might be douchebags, but at the end of the day, a lot of these guys are like the faces of YouTube.
Yeah.
So seeing them, you know, being like represented of YouTube as a whole and doing these like shitty things is going to make us look like shit. Yeah. Even though we're sitting here literally laughing at them for being how fucking dumb they were.
Yeah, it sucks.
Yeah, I mean, I always look at that side of YouTube and it's just so alien to me because I don't normally keep up with like, how can I say, like the kind of like side of YouTube, which is mostly like, I guess, based in LA and mostly like aimed towards, like
the LA YouTube scene, right?
Yeah, the LA YouTube scene is
it's
just
notorious
like,
just being insane.
It's like a different world to me. I don't get it sometimes. Yeah, and I would like to say that they don't obviously represent all of YouTube, but I think that's obvious to like most of our audience because I feel like there's very little audience like crossover between our stuff and their stuff to begin with.
But that's why I'm holding Trash Taste Coin, guys. Make sure they have those
TT
diamond,
coin.
The TT. Hold your diamond hands for the Trash Taste. Fucking hell.
Could you imagine? Monkey coin, rise up.
Monkey coin.
That'll be that's probably already a thing, to be fair.
Probably.
There's so many coins.
Yeah. Well, probably.
My God. Yeah. What else you guys been up to, huh?
Anyone? Well, I see what you guys have been up to, and that's getting your first vaccine shot that was broadcasted live.
Oh yeah, we did
on
that.
Like Japanese television.
That's all right. I got fucking stared down by like the Minister of Health or whatever he was.
Yeah, yeah. The
what was he again?
Well, I guess the Anthony Fauci of Japan.
Yes, essentially. Yeah, but yeah, we got a. Is it weird to say that our vaccine was sponsored?
This vaccine is sponsored by.
In a sense, it kind of was, but not really.
Well, it was and it wasn't.
I mean, you know, I don't know.
We didn't get paid to get vaccines, so I guess it wasn't sponsored.
Yeah, so the company that we work for is obviously a subsidiary of a subsidiary, which is owned by Kadokawa.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And Kadokawa in Japan, you know, I disagree with this. They were only really giving the vaccines out to big companies with over 1,000 employees, I think.
Yeah.
To give, so that they could give it to their employees.
Yeah.
But
yeah.
I just think that you should just give it to anyone who wants it.
You know?
Because apparently, you know, people, the elderly population here haven't been too receptive to it. They haven't been taking it much, whatever. So yeah, they had it. And I believe Kadokawa was like, all right, well, let's make it a press event.
Yeah.
And so.
Yeah, because Duango, which is the company that owns Nico Nico, which is like the Japanese YouTube essentially, they wanted to like do this program where they were like, we need to get foreigners living in Japan vaccinated. Because, you know, we want to show that off, right? Being like, it doesn't matter if you're a foreigner, you can get vaccinated here, guys. Yeah, like every foreigner living here isn't like, can you just give me the fucking vaccine already? Yeah, like, we know the vaccine exists. So yeah, they were like, well, Trash Taste has a lot of foreigners in it.
Yeah, so they were like, yeah, you can have the vaccine if you go on TV. And I was thinking like, fuck, well, it could be months before I get it here. I don't know when I'm going to get it, you know?
Yeah.
It's, you know, it's not like I've never done this before. Sure, fuck it. I'll get stabbed on TV.
Yeah. At least you weren't given the death glare, right?
Yeah, well, so what happened was is that we turn up to this place and we fill out a form and there's already like people like shuffling us around. And like, obviously it's a very strange experience if you've never been on like a press thing. And to be honest, we haven't been on many, but essentially you turn up at a place and then like a group of 10 people are like, come here, do this thing. And then they're shoving you around and you're just like, all right, okay, I'll just keep following. And then you're like, fill out this form, fill it out now. All right, okay, I'm filling it out. All right, come here, you got to get to do this. And then I'm like, all right, shit, what's going on?
Yeah,
fuck.
Yeah. And then meanwhile, this entire thing is live streamed on Nico Nico in front of, I think it was like 35,000 people.
Yeah, something.
Yeah, like I don't know what 35,000 people are just watching, just sitting there watching people getting vaccinated. Yeah.
I'm not sure if it was total views or live viewers, but it was a lot.
It was live viewers.
So I saw how many comments there were and it just like completely filled up the screen. Yeah. So with Nico Nico, it's not like YouTube comments where you can read them down on the bottom. Like if you comment something, it like appears live on the feed.
It's pretty cool. But also it's really distracting.
It's a cool feature, I think.
Yeah,
so then we get shuffled across to this other room with like 20 cameras and a bunch of people. And me and Jerry just look so out of place because everyone is wearing suits. And we're just like, all right.
And Connor and I are rocking in our JoJo suits.
Yeah, we wear JoJo shirts. So I was like, if I'm going on TV, I'm wearing JoJo merch. And then they were like, sit down here. And I was like, okay, cool. And literally like 2 seconds later after they told us to sit down, the health minister comes around the corner. And like Emperor Palpatine just stares us down like,
yes. Yeah, what the fuck was up with that death stare he gave you guys?
Wait, so before that as well, before right? That, yeah. He's like, how was it? And we were, and Joey didn't say anything.
He looked at me and he was like, in English, he was like, how was it? And I'm like, I was this close to being like, bro, I literally just walked in. Like, we haven't got it yet. We're waiting.
Yeah. So Joey didn't respond and we were really awkward. We were like confused. And then as he's walking, I'm like, oh, we haven't had it yet. And he goes, oh. And then just walks off, but then has a 5-minute conversation with the Japanese cosplayers. And me and Jay are like, all right, well,
all right, can we go get it now? Like,
wait, there were Japanese cosplayers there?
Yeah, there was someone from Final Fantasy VII next to me.
Just in cosplay?
In cosplay.
It was really strange.
Was this like a vaccine like event or was this like fucking Anime Expo or something?
I think the event was to like-
They were Japanese influencers.
Yeah, they were Japanese influencers. Okay. So it was like foreign influencers, Japanese influencers, musicians, talents, all that kind of stuff.
So they just came in costume.
That's
so weird. Yeah.
Well, no. I think we don't really give a shit. I think the Japanese talent very much care about upholding the image.
Like the image.
I mean, Jerry are like, fuck it, we'll just start with joking. Yeah. I mean, I guess that's upholding the image, right?
Yeah. And then when I was getting the vaccine, from my periphery, like I could see from my periphery, just the health minister staring down at me like.
This is a really funny video of like four angles of this guy just staring at Joe with like a whole press team behind him. It was really bizarre.
It looks so fucking ominous. It was like a really scene from like fucking JoJo or something.
It looked like a parody. Like when, especially when they're like zooming on him as well, I was just like, this is like built for memes.
It's like, yes, the anime man. Like,
it's
yes.
Literally Emperor Palpatine just walking around with his like subordinates. Yeah.
It's like, do it.
Snap him.
Yeah, because when I went like a few hours afterwards because I was busy winning a Shadowverse tournament at the time.
GG, by the way.
But yeah, I came in afterwards and it was like pretty chill for me. Mm. I didn't have any cameras, no interview. Did you guys have to do interviews or anything like that?
No, we just went on like a live stream afterwards and said, yeah. Watch Trash
Taste. Did you have to sit in front of like, there was like a weird like shrine looking thing after you got the shot? So after we got the shot, there was like seven camera angles on this Nico Nico live stream. But mm-hmm. one of the camera angles was it was on this table and it was through these like torii gates.
It was a really shit angle.
It was a really shit angle. Like you could barely see our faces, but basically they were like, once we got the shots done, we came out and they were like, oh, sit down and give us a couple of like words on how your experience was. So Connor and I got sat in front of this torii shrine and they were like, how was it? I was like, fuck with needle, wasn't it? Like, I've done this before, dude. It's just the vaccine. But then we used that as the opportunity to be like, what's Trash Taste?
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Damn, promoting Trash Taste during a vaccine.
Yeah, I guarantee most of them didn't understand what we said, but it's all right. It's the thought that counts.
I saw Sydney's clip where she went in front of it and she just says, yeah, I'm an aero-gay YouTuber. And she literally said that. And the comments were just like, what? Everyone thought she was like a JAV actress or something.
Oh my God.
Wow. Poor choice of words. But yeah, I mean.
So yeah, I guess I traded, you know, I did let them, we were guinea pigs for the press so that we could get vaccines.
Worth it, honestly.
Yeah, honestly, like when we got the offer from Malin, like Malin just messages us one day and was like, guys, good news. I can secure you guys a vaccine. And we're just like, great. Yeah. As hopefully many companies are getting vaccinated right now. That's fucking brilliant. And then she was like, but there's a catch. I was like, what do you mean there's a fucking catch? I just want to get vaccinated. Yeah. It's like, well, you can get it if you appear on Nico Nico and live stream it. I'm just like, what kind of sponsorship offer is this? This is like literally the weirdest sponsorship offer I've ever heard in my life.
We've never done anything
it's
with
not
Nico
really a
Nico.
Sponsorship.
No, it kind of felt like it at the time, but it wasn't technically a sponsorship offer, but.
Slowly getting there. First jab complete, next one in the end of this month.
End of this month, and then we'll be fully 5G'd up.
Yeah,
fully 5G. I'm honestly impressed because it just seemed like a switch just like flicked in like the Japanese vaccination program. Yeah. And like we went from no vaccines to everyone's getting a vaccine now.
Well, yeah, because I think it's because the government finally realized they were like, Olympics is a month away and no one's been vaccinated yet.
Yeah, they were like, that's not a good
look. We should probably do something about that.
Yeah, because Japan normally isn't used to really having eyes on them. They normally kind of very much like that.
Yeah.
And now they have all the eyes on them, watching literally everything they do and criticizing it. Yeah. So I don't think they're like used to it.
Yeah. But
America's like first time, huh?
I got these like really fucking awful back pains like day after I got the vaccine shot. Like, you know, most of the time it's like, oh, my left arm or whatever arm you got was sore. Mm-hmm. Or, you know, I got it on the left arm and like this entire part was just aching like fucking crazy. And I was like, I'm feeling sleepy. I'm feeling drowsy. Meanwhile, I woke up the next day and I was like, I feel like someone just like drop kicked me in the back. I don't know why.
It's so strange. I've never heard anyone say they got
that. It's weird, right? And it's like only me and Aki are the only ones that have got this side effect. Everyone else was just
If I scream too loudly, you might fucking turn into a titan.
I was about to say, obviously you were just injected with that fucking titan juice. That's why the health minister was like,
he better not become a fucking titan.
It's like they give you the vaccine, they put a bottle of wine there. We're going to put spoiler warning for that joke.
Oh, it was like fucking Historia looking at me, right? It's just like, you better not turn into a fucking titan, I swear to God.
We're going to put a spoiler warning. Yeah. Probably the first ever just casual spoiler we've ever
done. Yeah, yeah. This episode is sponsored by Boxu. What is this, Boxu? What, Joey?
Nothing. Isn't that the fabled premium Japanese snack box subscription services that delivers snacks straight from Japan to your door and offers free shipping to the US?
How do you guys know all of this? What?
Someone is transmitting some information right now directly to my brain. All right, here it comes again.
For those of you who would like to indulge in the wonderful snacks Japan has to offer, this is for you.
I personally recommend this one, the Suka gummies. Gan, have you tried these?
I can't control it.
So use coupon code TRASHTASTE20 to get 20% off your first authentic Japanese snack box from Boxu. Take advantage of this limited time offer.
Don't worry, Gan. I think this will help you out.
I feel a lot better now.
Sounds delicious.
Back to the show.
But when I got my jab, I was extremely tired the day of and I couldn't do anything. So I decided I was going to watch a TV show. It was an animation. Quite an anime.
Technically in Japan, that is an anime.
I watched Invincible.
Amazon Prime.
Is it good?
Oh my God, it's amazing.
Really?
It's
really good.
It's fucking amazing.
I need to watch
it. It's so good.
I'm like, there must be a reason why this show's getting memed a lot.
It's really good. Yeah. I was really blown away by how just incredible it was. Like,
cut to title screen right now.
Not Invincible.
Yeah. Oh yeah, Incredible. Sorry.
I was like, what are you fucking talking
about? I was like, oh, I love that Disney movie.
Oh, I love the Disney movie.
Not Pixar. Fuck.
Yeah. Yeah, it's great. I mean, fuck, man. It's so good. Yeah? I want season two now.
Can you sell it on to me? Like, what's it about? I know it's about superheroes.
It's kind of hard to sell it without spoiling it.
Okay.
Because there's a massive spoiler in the very first episode. Right.
It's one of those things that it is literally the best show to experience knowing nothing.
Okay, okay.
Because I almost think that me seeing some of the memes spoiled a bit for me.
Oh really?
But yeah, because I imagine those twists would have been so much more impactful if I didn't know they were coming.
Yeah,
but I knew they were coming because I saw the memes. But if anyone, I'm not going to talk too much about it. I will just say that it is probably one of the best TV shows I've watched in like the past year.
Yeah,
wow.
It is really fucking good.
Okay. How many episodes is it?
It's only 10.
Eight episodes and they're 45 minutes long.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And it's just amazing. Like, it's everything is fucking.
Did you watch The Boys
amazing.
At all?
I did not.
It's very similar to The Boys.
It's very similar to The Boys, which is funny that they're both like Amazon Prime exclusives.
Right,
but if you didn't watch The Boys, that's fine. It's I'd say a more brutal take on the superhero genre, maybe.
I heard The Boys is like super fucking gory, right?
Oh yeah.
I'd say like The Boys is more like humory.
Yeah.
A lot more humor involved. Yeah. And Invincible is just like pretty brutal.
Just brutal.
Brutal.
It's Invincible is less of like a parody or like a subversion of the superhero genre and more of just like, I don't know how to like describe it without spoiling major plot points. So
like a deconstruction maybe?
I wouldn't say it was a deconstruction.
It's just like, you know, if realistically, if superheroes are just randomly like powers that were given out, some people are going to be assholes.
Right. Okay.
Not that's what happens here, but it's just, I don't want to talk about it much other than it is amazing. I've watched it. Anyone watching this, if you've been thinking about it, 100% go
I've
watch
definitely
it.
Been thinking about that and The Boys. So
you should watch both because I like with watching Invincible, it was the first time, I remember after I finished the season or finished the series, it was the first time I had like an episode just really shock me. Cause like, you know, we watch a lot of anime, we read a lot of media. And so it's been the first time in a long time where something's just shocked me in that way because it's something that I just hadn't seen before.
Okay.
So that's why I think it's really worth watching and watch it before everyone starts jumping on this trend and everyone starts like trying to fucking rip them off or something or do their own take on it.
It was a comic before, if I'm not mistaken.
Yeah, it was a comic before.
And like from what I've heard and I've been told, like we haven't really had too many like comic book adaptations outside of the very safe, family-friendly Marvel-owned ones.
Yeah.
What I've been told and what my friends tell me, like there's so many good stories in the comic books that have just not been touched. Like so many mature ones as well. And I'm hoping that this will lead to more adaptations of really fucking mature comics.
I feel the last time we got like a mature comic adaptation that I thought was pretty good, or like it wasn't good, but it was really entertaining, was Sin City.
I never watched that.
Yeah.
The movie?
Yeah. That's originally based off a comic.
Was it?
Yeah.
I like Watchmen, the movie. I like that.
Yeah.
I like that movie.
I like how you just like really whispered that. I like Watchmen.
Because I feel like people don't
Isn't
like
it
that
Watchmen?
Movie.
Well,
Watchmen.
Watchmen. The Watchmen.
It's Inspector Gadget.
Yeah. No, because like, I heard the same thing about Sin City as well. Because like a lot of people are like, no, it was crap. You know, it was like, it was over the top, you know, all that kind of stuff. But I'm like, isn't it supposed to be over the top? Yeah. It's a comic book.
I'm sure there's a bunch of comic book aficionados in the comment section that will tell us, actually, there's these amazing adaptations.
Yeah.
Because I heard that Watchmen was just really hated by everyone who read the comics. And I watched it and I was like, I thought it was a good movie. I have no idea about the source material. Same thing with V for Vendetta as well. That was I fucking love that movie. And apparently comic book readers hated it. I don't know why. Maybe they have a legitimate reason.
I feel that's the same with like anything.
Bro, it could be fucking Tokyo Ghoul. Manga readers right now.
Yeah. It's literally just all manga readers being like, oh no, it wasn't that good. The manga was way better. It's literally the comic book was way better.
As an anime fan, I know how it is.
As a manga reader, I know how it is.
I know we're going from topic to topic fast here, but speaking of that kind of topic of manga and anime adaptations and whatnot, not getting it right, I recently watched and read Records of Ragnarok.
Okay.
And I know that's going to be, because when I was live streaming, people were like, oh, well, Netflix paid you to react to it, so you can't say a bad thing about it. No, that's not true. We can say bad things about it. And I'm going to. With that as well, we just reacted to it. It wasn't like you have to say good thing. It was like react to it, but you know, if you please don't be too mean, you know.
Yeah, don't like rip us to shreds. Yeah,
and I'm not gonna be like, oh, thank you for bringing me here, Netflix. Wow, this looks like shit. Yeah. Like, when we're talking about it, I will give my honest opinions on.
To be fair, the scenes that we did react to were probably the better scenes.
Yeah, they definitely showed us the better fight of the two. Even then it was like, you know, it was all right.
Especially compared to the manga.
Because like, I will say this, we obviously were sponsored by Netflix to react to it. Mm. And we tried to give like, I mean, I was honestly hype for the show in general because I'm a huge fan of the manga. Mm. So I was pretty hype. And we were obviously shown, we weren't shown the entire episode. We were shown just like clips of
it. Like 5 minutes of it?
Like the same thing as like the trailer, right?
Yeah.
And you know, I honestly,
the opening to Record of Ragnarok was fucking hype. It's Max from the Hormone, which is the Death Note second opening.
So
it was fucking hype.
Yeah, exactly. And I honestly went into it with high hopes because why wouldn't I? And because I watched the final product as well, and I will say I am disappointed with how it was adapted because I feel like the fights deserved better treatments, and I don't know what happened in the production process or what kind of went on behind the scenes, but it wasn't the final product that I was personally hoping for.
Yeah.
I think it was fine. Like, I saw a lot of YouTube videos where people were like, it's fucking awful. Don't support this shit. It's terrible. I was like, you know what? Like, it's still better than a lot of adaptations we've had, like, in recent memory. Mm. You know, like, I feel like they bastardized One Punch Man season 2 way more than this
did. Really? I don't think so.
Man, some of the One Punch Man fights were so appalling in season 2.
Yeah, but I feel like, I don't know, it's a tough one. It's because for both of them, I would recommend the manga over the anime.
Yeah.
Like, no, definitely. 100%.
But even then, reading Records of Ragnarok going back, I'm like, yeah, this is cool. And you could do this anime adaptation the way that I think people wanted, but it's just never going to happen. Like, I don't think we're ever going to get the Record of Ragnarok adaptation that people wanted. Like,
no,
I don't think the story is that good where a company would believe in it enough. Like, I read it, right? And it's cool.
Yeah.
But like, the story's fine.
There isn't much of a story.
Like, it's literally just a battle show. Yeah. Like, which is fine. It's cool. Mm-hmm. But I was sitting there and I'm like, I could see why, you know, this is never going to be the most popular manga. Like, this is never going to be in like the top 10. You know what I mean?
It purely just builds itself up. Am I wrong in saying that? Like,
it doesn't need to be in the top 10 to get a decent adaptation. I mean, you know, we can talk about the Berserk adaptation. That's definitely a top 10 manga. Look at the adaptations it got, right?
I've gotten so used to the current climate of adaptation we've been getting. And I'm like, I just couldn't see a show that is literally all fighting, like 24 minutes, been done justice where anime is right now.
Well, I would say look at God of High School, right? God of High School has a very mid story. Mm. The story of the anime was very mid as well. But my fucking God, the fight scenes and the animation were absolutely amazing, right? Mm. And I feel like God of High School and Records of Ragnarok have a lot of similarities. And I mean, they're both just like tournament arc, the anime.
But God of High School had a big focus on martial arts and like that kind of movement. And I feel like that was specific to that director. Who knew very much.
Yeah, I mean, the director was very fucking talented because it's the same guy who did Jujutsu Kaisen. But I'm saying this, that, you know, it could have got a good adaptation, but unfortunately, I think
it's the most 5 out of 10 adaptation.
Really?
Records of Ragnarok, yeah. It's pretty much bog standard, I thought. Like, It's a li- like at times it was disappointing, but when I read the manga, I was like, well, it kind of gives you the same feeling. I'm not going to lie.
Really?
Genuinely.
I thought the manga art was fucking incredible, which is really like you've already sold me on this. Yeah, it's a mediocre story because it's just a fucking tournament arc, but it's just dumb fun. It's cool. It's like a lot. It's just a lot of fun.
And it's just like, hype thrown through.
I know I'm going to get shit for this. I read both the, so there's a fight between Adam and Eve and Zeus.
And Zeus.
And everyone was like, this is the most epic fight of all time. And I was like, yeah, it's pretty good. And I was reading it and I was like, I actually think it was better in the anime, even though it wasn't even that good.
Are you for real?
Yeah.
Are you actually for real?
That fucking screenshot, like fucking, you know, where the panel loads, I'm like, it's literally like reading the manga. it's literally reading the manga with pre-animated slides.
Welcome to Trash Taste, everybody.
What is this take I'm hearing right now?
I just think
you were the guy who couldn't get over the fucking like animated manga in what was it, Way of the House Husband, and here you are in an actual anime that needs animation because it's an action anime, and you prefer it.
I realize this is making me look terrible. I remember because that just the way it was, there was some animation that I was like, I don't like how this looks. But this one, they literally just showed screenshots of the fucking fight in the manga. And I'm like, you know what? At least they just gave up. At least they were like, you know what? Let's not even try.
What are you
talking about? I genuinely wish I was joking because I know this is weird, but I genuinely didn't care. I was like, that's fine.
Wait, so you prefer the anime adaptation of that fight?
Okay, so I watched the anime and then I read the manga. It might have been an order thing, but yeah, I was like, yeah, I think I just preferred watching the-
You're on crack.
I really liked the music and the voice acting. It added so much to it too.
I've never fucking heard that an opinion that's just so wrong.
I'm gonna get grilled for this. I know.
I wanna know if there's a single fucking person watching this right now that will actually agree with
you. Who's like, finally. I'm not the only one.
It's just like, I know that like, when you look at it, you're like, this looks better. But I don't know, it's personal preference. I just thought that when I was watching it, I was like, I think this deserves to be at, like, have like music, a voice acting. I don't know why. I just enjoyed that more. Like when I carried on reading the manga, I thought this is good, but like I actually wanted to just see the animation.
Is the guy who watches Seven Deadly Sins season 3 and is just like, you know what? Okay, it's probably better than the manga.
See,
that's what I'm saying, right? Would I rather what we get is just like the manga colored, or would I rather Seven Deadly Sins season 3? Fuck no, get that out of here. They literally made the art 10 times worse than it is in the manga. At least they just took the fucking art from the manga.
So like, if I literally grabbed the manga and colored it in and then played some music as you read it.
And voice acting? Yeah, if you literally can't animate it, don't. Just do that. Like, you know what I mean? Like,
just do the old cell like movement.
Well, it's like fucking, what is it? Like, I love the like Circle Toons animation on YouTube, right? Where he just does that. I'm like, just around, do that. Yeah. Just fucking do that, bro.
I mean,
I genuinely don't know why. I know it sounds strange because I guess I've just become so detached to giving a shit where like these people seem to like fucking seethe weekly about manga art not being adapted properly. And it's like-
No, I get that. Yeah. Like that's obviously taking it too far.
And I know that this obviously isn't that good, but also at the same time, I'm like, have we not learned that this is the norm? Like this is what we're getting?
I mean, I don't think so because I feel like with anime art, and manga art, it's two totally different mediums, right? And that's-
I just wanted to look close enough.
Yeah, because I feel like, for example, I'm bringing up another example now and I'm talking about Junji Ito adaptations. Because did you watch the Junji Ito, like the short story adaptation? I can't remember what it was called.
Yes, unfortunately, I did.
That was literally just like copying the manga page panel by panel by panel, but there's just-
And then making it underwhelming.
Yeah, and then just making it completely underwhelming. And that's just because the art just couldn't be transferred over to the big screen. Or like, there just wasn't enough detail in the art.
So I find that with fights, I find them so much more frustrating to figure out reading a manga than in an anime.
I get that.
Because there's some fights where I'm like, wait, what the fuck is going on?
No, I get that. But the thing is, the Zeus versus Adam fight in the manga is very easily understand.
Yeah.
No, like, I know exactly what's happening.
It's basically just two dudes punching the shit out of each other. Yeah. How can you fuck that up? How do you not know what's
going
on there?
We're not talking about like the Demon Slayer fucking room rotating fight. Right? It's literally just you're in a fucking stadium, you know?
But it was like, I was like, all right. And so I read the manga and I'm like, yep, it's just two dudes. Like they were literally just like auraing each other. Yeah. And I'm like, what about this? Where people like coming to the manga? I'm like, it's literally just like people just punch like fists, the exact same like page over and over again.
People just like detailed fights in manga, I guess. Yeah.
I appreciate it. I look at it, I'm like, that's nice. But also I want the voice.
So did you enjoy the anime then?
Yeah, I had a great time with it. You know, like people were being like, it's unwatchable. It's a good show.
It's not unwatchable.
It's so easy to turn your brain off and enjoy that show.
Yeah, it's like, not to the point where it's unwatchable, but I feel like it took like a really good manga and made it an average show. That's how I feel. That's my honest opinion.
I feel like the manga is kind of average.
You think so?
Reading it, I'm like, you know what? After the first two fights, every single fight after that, I think there's three more fights after that, I predicted who was going to win immediately, just based off how they entered. It was so obvious. Like the latest fight in the manga as well, the one that's been finished, was so obviously that the guy was going to lose that from the start that I was totally uninvested.
Just talking about, I haven't read the latest manga.
I haven't read the latest fight.
What was the last fight that you saw in the manga?
It was Jack the Ripper. Was the one I saw.
I loved that fight.
That was a great fight.
I knew that Jack the Ripper was going to win. It was very obvious.
Wow, spoilers.
That he was spoilers. The next fight, after that fight, I think you'll immediately be able to tell who's going to win within like the first two chapters.
I mean, you know, I'd be lying if I said that I didn't foresee.
But that's what I thought was, so good about the, I think that's genuinely, everyone's like, it's the art about Adam and Zeus fight that was the best. I don't think that was the best part about Adam and Zeus. No. Adam and Zeus, I didn't know until the last moment who was going to win that fight.
Right, right.
There's that. And it was just, I loved how the fight just evolved and progressed.
Yeah.
It's basically every trope about like an anime fight put into this one fight, but just like expanded to 10 or 11. Yeah. Like it was just pure macho fun. And you know, it doesn't require a lot of thinking, doesn't require a lot of brain. It's just fun. And that's what I love about Records of Ragnarok. Yeah. It like takes out all the bullshit. Just like, we know you don't care about story. We know you don't give a shit about story. Yeah. Here, let me just give you fights and fights and fights. And that's what I love about it, you know?
But that's where I felt that when everyone was saying, oh, it's the art, it's the fights. And I'm like, it is. But like, I think the really good thing that it had going, especially in the start, and I think probably what made it so appealing to people is that the fights in the start, I genuinely had no idea who was going to win.
Yeah.
Like, I could not. I didn't have any idea. And then I feel like after the third fight, especially, I thought was so boring. And I was like, I sleep. And it was obvious he was going to win from the start.
Yeah. I feel like just the way that show was just constructed in general was not meant for like long form, you know, serialization. Like, because again, it's like, oh, cool. Here's the 17th fight.
Well, because the way the show did it in the start, it was like, here's two guys. None of them are bad guys. Second fight. Here's two guys. Very strong. None of them are bad guys. Make your own mind up who you want to root for. Third fight. This guy's the bad guy. Real bad. No one likes him. Third guy. Oh, this guy's the good guy. Oh, he's real good. And then the good guy wins. And then you're like, all right. And then the fourth one, it's so obvious he's trying to do the old switcheroo. He's like, oh, he's the bad guy. Oh, he's good. Oh, we want him to lose, you know? And it's so obvious because he tries to sell it so hard at the show. Sorry, I'm getting off it. But yeah, it's fine. I feel like it definitely got weaker. And even though I've caught up to it, I don't know how much I'm going to keep reading it because I feel like I've had enough. I'm like, yeah, man, I don't really care. I care about keep reading
it. I mean, for me, I just read it whenever I'm looking for some dumb fun, switch my brain off. Because like what I feel like the biggest difference between the manga and the anime adaptation for me was that the anime is just missing this intensity that I kind of felt when reading the manga. And I'm pretty sure it's just because when you're reading manga, you know, because of the art, you feel this intensity because like you're filling in the gaps with your mind, right? That's how reading manga works for me, at least. With anime, you don't, you know, it's presented right in front of you because the movement is there, right? And that's why, to me, like, imagine if One Punch Man season one got the same adaptation as season two, right? What part of the big appeal of One Punch Man, the manga at least, is the art is fucking incredible, right?
Yeah.
And I feel like just because you see the difference between season one and season two, and just because season two just feels so much more flat compared to the manga, and that's just because the story's there, you got the same story, but just the intensity of the
art.
There's
no impact.
The intensity of the impact of the fight.
Even though it was slightly disappointing, I still love season two of One Punch Man. I really enjoyed it, honestly. I love One Punch Man, man. It's one of my favorite manga and shows of all time. Like, I think
I get that. I love but the like, story. I don't know how you can watch season one and being like, that was fucking incredible, and then watch, you know, a show that was season, half as good as
season one of Trash Taste. We find out Connor doesn't have ears. Season two of Trash Taste. We find out Connor doesn't have eyes.
No, I'm not saying.
Just turning into fucking Helen Keller.
I'm not saying that One Punch Man season two is not a downgrade. It is. It's still a banger show, though. It's still great. Like, One Punch Man for me, although the action was amazing, it was like the amazing tiramisu after your 5-course meal. You know, the animation, right? To me, it was always the story in One Punch Man. Like, because it seems like it doesn't have it. But then season two, they introduce Garu. Oh my God, I love that. It's such a good aspect in the story. Mm. I love how it plays into it. And then the manga now is amazing. Like, I fucking love reading
it. I don't think the story, I mean, this is going to one hot take to another, right? Honestly, I don't think the story
shit
of-
Shit on what I love, Grant, do it. Just shit on what I love.
I don't know. I don't think the story of One Punch Man is like top tier. I think it's a good story, but like if you're gonna talk about story from one, I mean, fucking Mob Psycho 100, I think has a way better story than One Punch Man.
I have to agree with that.
Like,
what? Yeah, I guess. Mob's more of a neater story. Everything wraps up nicely. It just feels
like it's more of a story. And I'm not saying One Punch Man doesn't have a story. Obviously, I think it has a pretty decent story.
I would rank Mob higher than One Punch Man.
Yeah, but by far, Mob to me is the full package.
Not by far. Calm down, right, Grant?
It is.
All right, come on.
Mob Psycho is like pretty much the full package on everything you want. It's got a great animation. It's got a very good story, very well written characters. And I feel like One Punch Man
just kind of wrote off a gimmick.
It kind of, essentially, like I like.
And they turned a gimmick into a lovable story.
They turned a gimmick into a lovable story, which I feel couldn't sustain itself.
I don't know. I disagree. I think the story right now is amazing.
I'm not saying the story is bad.
Yeah, fuck you,
in One Punch Man. I think it's great, but I think Mob Psycho definitely had a better story.
Yeah, but Mob Psycho is finished.
Yeah,
and One Punch Man's still going. Scientists, check that. Bigger length equals better story. Wait, no, I mean to admit One Piece is good. No, I take that back.
It's amazing.
No, I don't know. I don't know. Although I agree that Mob Psycho 100 is probably the strongest story, there's something about One Punch Man season 2 that really gets me. I don't know. Gets me going.
It's just your personal preference, right?
I guess so.
You're entitled to your wrong opinion.
Yeah, I mean, for me, season 2 was okay. It was okay.
Yeah,
it was great. I mean,
season two for me was just like, all right, like time to read the manga.
Even in the manga, I feel like that arc that season 2 adapted was one of the lesser exciting parts of the story. I feel like the real good part of the story is what comes
the arc after.
The arc after. That's when the story starts getting interesting. But yeah. I mean, the issue is that you got to deal with Saitama as a story element, and I feel like he just hasn't, or there hasn't been like the right way to like deal with it. Because I feel like the most interesting part of One Punch Man season 2 and season 3 is Garo. And I feel like that was the element that he added to try to save that, but Saitama is still there, and there's only so much you can play off that.
Season 3?
I'm saying if season 3 did get adapted.
Yeah.
We haven't heard anything about that, have we?
No.
Did it get announced?
No, I don't think so.
No.
Did Mob Psycho season 3 get announced?
I don't think there's enough for season 3, is there? From what I understand, there's not that much left of Mob Psycho.
I don't know. I didn't finish Mob Psycho.
I don't know.
But
what? How did you not finish it?
Because he's the anime man.
Because I just had not enough time. Because I was reading other things.
Bruh. What? It's so good.
Because I was reading what is probably going to be anime of the year, aka Chainsaw Man.
Oh God, yeah, that trailer dropped. And it had like 10 million views on Twitter.
Yeah.
Oh my gosh.
I mean, if we're going to talk about a trailer that made me nut, that's a trailer
that made me nut. Oh yeah, that trailer definitely I knew what they were doing.
I was like, Mappa, you son of a bitch.
You son of a bitch,
Mappa, you did it again.
Mappa were doing Attack on Titan, right? And then I saw all those comments that people were like, oh, why couldn't they animate Attack on Titan like this? What's going on?
Well, do you remember the first Attack on Titan season 4 trailer? It looked fucking amazing.
Yeah.
But like compared to the final product.
That's what I'm scared of.
That's what I'm very scared of.
We also learned from like when Ken came on the podcast, shout out to that episode.
Yeah.
He was telling us, you know, it's not really about the studio. It's about the guy in charge and who he brings on.
Yeah, it's about the director and the team of animators. Right,
yeah.
So, you know, if you have good connections and you can bring someone on, almost feel like the studio almost doesn't matter sometimes. It's a slight indication, but I feel like it's so inconsistent.
No,
yeah, I mean, it's definitely, a lot of it has got to do with the team behind it and the director behind it. I mean, we just talked about Jujutsu Kaisen, also by MAPPA, that was like such a well-animated show, even compared to like other MAPPA shows. Mm. I think that's just mostly because of the team behind it.
Yeah.
And I'm hoping that Chainsaw Man gets a good adaptation. I haven't even read the fucking manga.
Well, I reread the manga when the trailer dropped.
You know when you have those shows or those you know, properties, I don't know what you call them.
IPs
where you just know they're going to be bangers. Yeah. And so you're not like in a rush to jump into it. You're like, I know I've got something coming.
Yeah,
yeah, yeah.
Got a little present under the Christmas tree. I can unwrap it anytime. You know, it's there. you need to like a 10 out of 10 in the waiting, just in case.
Yeah,
you know? And that's definitely mine right now. I'm like, I know it's coming.
I'm honestly.
It's airing this fall, right? Chainsaw Man?
It's either this year or early next year.
Fuck, this year, Jesus. Like this year doesn't need another good anime. My fucking God, it's getting too much now. Much to watch.
I've not watched that much anime. I just kind of watch it if it's on Netflix now. I've become so normie that like I don't really want, I just don't want to have to deal with like shitty websites now. It really takes me out of it.
No, I feel that. I feel that.
Yeah, I watched like the first episode of Treze.
Yeah.
The Filipino one. Yeah. It was pretty good.
Yeah.
I need to watch more of it, but it seemed pretty good so far.
What's Treze about?
It's the one that's set in Manila in the Philippines.
Yeah, it's basically, think of if Ghost in the Shell and Blood Sea had a baby and was born in the Philippines.
Okay.
That's what that show
Ghost Hunter show kind
Ghost,
of thing.
Ghost Hunter, like Monster Hunter.
It's pretty badass. Yeah. I mean, I really enjoyed everything I saw from it so far. Just need to watch it and actually form an opinion on it.
Yeah, the weird thing about Netflix anime or Netflix shows is that like you just browse on Netflix and there's this show that you've just never heard of before. Mm. And you're like, has anyone talked about this? I don't know. Like, no, I've literally seen no exposure for this one show. Yeah. And you just end up putting it on and you're like, oh, that's pretty decent.
I mean, that's how I felt about Castlevania, right?
Yeah, yeah,
bro,
yeah.
Where it's like, when that first came out, I was like, oh, what is this? I never saw even Netflix promoting this show. And I was like, oh, I'll give it a go. I like the games. And I watched it was fucking amazing.
Yeah, I heard they might be producing a spinoff or something.
Oh, really?
Yeah, because apparently that story's over.
All right, right, right.
But they might be doing a spinoff, which I really want because I want more sexy voice acting.
Yes, please.
Oh, powerhouse. So watch Castlevania if you haven't already.
Yeah, the only anime I've been watching recently, which I highly recommend, is Odd Taxi.
I've been meaning to watch
that. Something that's just gone under the radar and it is probably like, I think maybe my anime of the season. I don't know. It's tough. Ooh. Like it really was a sleeper hit.
I can tell you what's not anime of the season. Fucking One Rogue Priority over here.
Yeah, I know.
God, we're so sorry.
We'll get onto that. But yeah,
from Odd Taxi, I don't know anything, but I've also been told that you don't want to know anything because it spoils it.
Yeah.
From what everyone's told me, and that's probably why it's having a hard time getting promoted.
Just go into a blind,
if you tell people what it's about, it sounds like one of those shows that kind of gets ruined a bit when or spoiled if you tell them even anything
kind
about it.
Kind of. It's more so if like, it's kind of hard to tell you what it is about because it's about
a lot of things.
I assume
it's about taxis.
Kind of. Like the biggest thing, the reason it's called Odd Taxi is because the main character is a taxi driver,
okay.
I guess. But I guess like, The easiest way to describe it is kind of like a Tarantino movie or something along those lines.
Yeah. Is it like Taxi Driver, the Scorsese film?
You said that to me and I was like, I'm pretty sure I know what's going to happen in this thing, just off that description alone, where I'm like, I bet there's going to be like a bunch of people who come in the taxi and they seem all unrelated. And then we find out that everything is all related and tied together in a neat story. Right. I bet that's what it was.
Yeah, that's exactly what it's like.
Right. Well, Tarantino.
Okay. But I mean, that's like the easiest way you can describe it because it is kind of like a Tarantino movie. And what I love about Odd Taxi is that it's been so long since I've just seen an anime that has just set up its premise, told its story, and then just wrapped everything up in a neat little package. And the part of the reason I think it like blew up a lot in like the past week is just because its ending was just really fucking good. It tied everything up. And
it's finished now?
Yeah, it's finished now.
How many episodes?
It's 13 episodes and you watch this anime and it's 13 episodes and that's it. There's no more. Everything's tied up. It's a really, really good ending.
Well, how do we milk it for more? If it's gone, how do we merchandise it?
I don't know.
God,
I don't
think
know
about these things.
I don't know.
You gotta love an anime that has a clean ending.
Yeah, it's just clean. It's just a clean anime. And it's been so long since I've seen an anime that has just got a really tight script where it sets up everything it needs to set up. It Erased. Gives you the right. Yeah, exactly. Just like Erased.
Yes, it gives you just like it.
It gives
just
you the like right it climax for everything that's set up, and then it just ends. And I'm just like, damn. Epic. Damn, that's just everything I need in a show. That's what I love about watching TV shows. And
damn,
it's been so long since I've seen a TV show.
I gotta watch Boys, like Odd Taxi. I was about to say Erased, not Erased.
Invincible,
that's it, yeah. So many to watch.
And apparently, I didn't watch One Direct Priority, but I heard it was a mess.
Yeah, I watched up to episode 10, I think. So I'm only-
You should probably just stop you're at.
I loved what I saw.
Yeah, you should probably stop where you're
at. Okay, so what the fuck happened?
Basically, I don't want to give too much away, but basically half of the OVA is a fucking recap, which already was like a red flag to me. I was like, we don't need a recap.
We don't do that here.
We don't do that here.
Why didn't they need a recap in an ending?
You asked me, man. You fucking asked me.
Wait, in a 20 minute episode?
40. I think it was 40, 45, something like that.
Oh, okay, so it was-
So it was
two episodes.
About 15 minutes of it was a recap. It was a really fucking long recap. At least it felt like a long time to me.
Well, when they get too comfortable with recap and shit, you know something's going wrong. You're like, and then get a little too comfortable with those recaps over there, huh, anime?
And then they just added like three new elements to the story that just was introduced but never resolved. So we're like, wait. So you literally just added this element like 20 minutes before the ending. And then that's it.
You know when people like love a show so much they don't want to admit that it's wrong? I bet those people on Twitter that like, I bet those people on Twitter that were like, no, guys, hold on. They might be onto something here.
Yeah.
please do something. Fix what you've done, please.
And it was just like, and it just felt so shitty. Because like, again, like the first season when I watched it, it was fucking amazing, right? Like you watched up until episode 10.
Yeah,
it's fucking amazing, right?
Couldn't wait for it to be concluded.
Yeah, and unfortunately it wasn't even concluded with the final episode. It just left more questions than answers. And we were just like, cool.
So wait. When they didn't conclude it, did they leave room for a season two or was that just well, fuck you guys, this is how it ends.
I think they tried to do like a really like open-ended like Madoka-esque ending, except unlike Madoka ending, nothing was explained. So like you couldn't even form theories about what was anything, right? Like at least the Madoka ending, it was kind of like, all right, we can kind of figure
your
out-
life leaves chat.
Yeah, it's like we can kind of figure out why it ended like this, right? It's a lot of it is like very like, you know, metaphorical and everything. Uh-huh. It's like, okay, we can kind of figure out theories of what this might mean. But with Wonder, they kind of did that, but they were like, no clues for you. Figure it out.
Are you like the show? Fuck you.
Yeah.
Fuck you.
It literally was just like, it felt like CloverWorks was just like, all right, I give up. Okay, end it. Roll the credits.
Didn't CloverWorks also adapt Promised Neverland?
Promised Neverland season 2.
they've been on a not a great streak currently, unfortunately. which is such a shame because like they always start off so strong, right? Promised Neverland started off really strong. One Direct started off really strong and just none of them have been able to like stick the landing.
Everyone's gonna, anytime they get anything now that's going good, everyone's gonna be like, guys, don't get excited.
Yeah.
Just wait.
Just wait until the ending happens. Yeah, because I was so disappointed when I heard that because I was actually, I watched up to episode 10 and I really, really was enjoying it. Yeah. But then I remember thinking, man, they gotta, still setting up plot points and still exploring characters 10 episodes in.
Yep. Yeah.
It's gotta end in three episodes. That's not a lot of time
left. It definitely was built, I feel, for a 24 episode, like a two core series, but I feel like they just weren't given the opportunity to.
I just also can't believe what they did to Promised Neverland season 2. So if you don't know, Promised Neverland was an amazing show. One of the best selling manga, right?
It's like in top five, right? It sold more than My Hero Academia.
Yeah, it's like the fourth, top five best selling manga of all time. The first season was amazing if you haven't watched
it. The manga's fantastic.
And then instead of just like doing what they were doing, they're like, now hold on guys, what if we just do something else?
they were literally like, all right, so we just finished the current arc. How many chapters do we have left? Like 150? How many episodes do we have left? Three. All right, skip about 120 episodes and just go straight to the end.
That's literally what they did. They fucked the show up completely.
And then the final episode was literally a PowerPoint presentation.
And then, and you know how it is. You know, there's like, when you get a bad adaptation, there's a cooldown period where there's not a set rule, but it's like a societal rule where you can't make a remake now within the next 10 years. Yeah. So there's 10 years now, we're not gonna get a good Promised Neverland adaptation until someone is like, wow, dust this off.
Yeah.
Look at this.
I mean, they tried to recover with the live action, but that was also horrible.
That was a live action.
It was Korean though, right?
It was Japanese.
But I saw the poster. It looked like a fucking porno film. I don't know why. I think most live action anime adaptations
do look like a porno film.
I think porno parodies actually kind of look better sometimes.
Like movie posters also look like Japanese porn posters. Yeah. It's the same production quality. It's really bizarre.
Yeah.
I've seen
AX cosplay shoots that look better than some of these posters, you know? Like it's wild seeing like just how they look sometimes. Like I remember the Full Metal Alchemist like live action one. And
I still haven't seen that movie and I fucking refuse to because I saw the trailer. I'm like, this is like, if someone with like 500 subs uploaded this as like a April Fool's like parody movie, yeah, I would believe it. Like it was that bad. The costumes were horrible looking. Edward looked like a crack addict, like with his like hair, it's just like all over the place. I'm like, no, don't do this. Why would you massacre my boy like that? It looks so bad. Oh God.
I just can't get over how they all look like porn videos. I just like.
They actually do.
Dead ass. Like I've seen some like porn like parodies of anime that look better than some live action anime.
I also had this thought the other day. I'm like, you know, put on a JAV and I was like, how come I
just casually?
I was on the train, put some JAV and I thought, huh, how come I've never seen one above 640p?
Right.
Never. I've never seen a JAV.
I think it's just because they go straight to DVD, right?
Yeah.
Probably.
The motherfuckers, they got 1080p lying around? Like, I just thought about it.
It's because the ones that are 1080p are hidden behind a paywall.
Yeah, but surely someone's pirating them, right?
Of course.
I'm just like, I was sitting there and I'm like, these posters, they're like movie posters.
Yeah,
amazing,
yeah.
Immaculate posters. And every single time, yeah, I'm fighting for my life to find 720p. I'd be lucky if I can find it. And I thought, what's up with that? Why is it only?
I don't know, maybe.
I cannot tell, you know, I don't even have an inkling of what year JAVs, JAV, if you don't know, is the Japanese porn.
Yeah.
I have no idea what year these were made. I don't even have an idea of when they were made.
Yeah.
You know, you go on the American porn.
Yeah.
They're in fucking 8K.
Yeah.
Yeah.
What's going on? What's going on, Japan?
I don't think anyone's looking for like 8K pixelation of dick, you know?
No.
It's still going to be pixelated at the end of the day.
It's not that I need it. I just think the technology is available. You know, I know they can get these cameras. Why aren't they?
Yeah. Or maybe what it is that the actual JAV is in like 4K, but then it's the pirates who are like, I'll just download the HD version.
No way. I refuse to believe there's not. For some reason, I've never seen it. Have you ever seen it? I've never seen it.
What, 1080p JAV?
Yeah.
Yeah, I've seen it.
Where?
Again, it's hidden behind a paywall.
Oh my God. I'm like, tell me your sources, straight. Tell me. I need to know. I was thinking, sorry. We were talking about the movie. Yeah.
I mean, I'm sure it's out there somewhere deep down in the web, but like, can I be bothered to look for it? No.
No, that's me too. I don't want to spend more than 5 minutes.
No. Yeah. Speaking of things I've been watching,
okay, yep,
it's not a TV show or a movie or an anime.
Ooh, okay.
I was watching a particular live stream.
Oh.
Yes.
Okay.
I know what you're gonna mention.
Women always say men don't have feelings. Well, I definitely had feelings when I was watching Coco's graduation live stream.
Dude, that was fucking insane, man.
That was nuts. I think I saw like on the news, that I think it was like, or like internet news, I mean, not TV news. I saw on the internet news that I think that ended up being, I think, the seventh highest
live stream
of all time.
Yeah, I saw that as well.
I think she capped at 480,000 people watching her live.
Yeah. During the concert bit, it was like 480,000. I was kind of wondering if it was going to break 500K.
Yeah, I was like, come on, half a mil.
You can do it, Sims, come on. I believe in you.
It was nuts because I was watching that live and there's some parts the chat was going so fast that it was literally lagging the stream.
Yeah, I saw.
I was, it was crazy.
But I was occasionally popping in and just seeing what was going on.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I didn't care much about like the whole like idol side of things because I've never really cared about the whole Hololive idol side of things or whatever. But like, yeah, there were parts where I was just like, getting a little emotional.
Honestly, same. Cause I couldn't watch it live because we were doing something at the time, but I watched like the recording afterwards. Yeah. And honestly, it was like, I'm, as I've said, I watched less VTubers now than I did last year, but man, it was getting emotional at some points, Holy shit. But I honestly think this is an end of an era for Hololive because I think Hololive owes Coco so fucking much, right? Because she is basically the sole reason why Hololive is as big internationally. She's basically the reason why Hololive English exists, right?
Exactly.
And I feel like, to me, it was like the end of an era for Hololive because, you know, she's done so much for the company and now she's just not there anymore. And, you know, I feel like she did move out of her own accord, which is happy that no big like controversy happened to make her move.
It was fully respectable that she was just like, I kind of just don't want to be here anymore for whatever reason. See you later.
Which just made it even more bittersweet because I'm happy that she made the decision to move on and do whatever she wants to do now. But you know, it is.
And she went out with a fucking bang.
Holy shit.
Like I saw those super chats, bro. It was, I don't want to think about how much money she made from that.
If you're not enjoying it, go out on top, right?
Yeah.
And then also, I mean, she clearly enjoys doing other stuff on the side.
Yeah.
So why not, right? Like, and you can bring a massive audience over with you. So if you do a show like that, like people are of course going to check out what you're doing next. So it was a brilliant idea as well. Like,
exactly.
Because I mean, I think honestly, Coco, in terms of just like looking at each talent as content creators, I do think she is genuinely one of the most talented content creators in Hololive. And that's just, and I mean, if she wasn't, then she wouldn't have had the success that she did internationally, I think.
Also, can I say massive brain idea that she pre-recorded like the interview sections and put English subtitles on
Yeah.
I was like, that is so giga brain.
Because I was like, wait, how are they subtitling this at first? I was like, whoa, is there just a
madman?
The JoJo event panel, people are like, how are they doing this? It's impossible.
At first I just thought that I was like some fucking light speed translator at the back going, it's like, I got this boys, I got this.
Yeah, I was like, that's so giga brain because she clearly knows how, like, I reckon her international fan base was just as big as a Japanese fan base.
Yeah.
Right? So it's like, why not get both of them in at the same time, right?
Yeah.
Like, so giga brain.
I mean, I feel like that's why the live stream was partly how it broke so many records, right? It's just because it wasn't just the Japanese audience watching. I mean, it wasn't only just gonna be the Japanese audience watching it anyway, but there was always going to be a big part of the audience that just didn't get what was going on. And I was like, should I cry now? Is it the goodbye time? No,
right now?
But no, like thanks to the subtitles, everyone could get involved in it. So it was just like a five head move.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah,
and being sad.
What did you think of
it? I didn't really watch it. I mean, I was watching it occasionally. I was like, wow, this is pretty cool.
Yeah.
It was all right. I mean, again, like I've mentioned before, I don't really like, I'm not like a massive simp of any of them.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know if that's a derogatory term. I don't
particularly, banned on Twitch.
Yeah, I don't particularly like watch a lot of them. I know people are like, well, will you collab with them? But yeah, it's different though.
Yeah.
So I, you know, to me it was like, all right, I mean, it was cool. Like it was an epic show
from what
I saw. Epic. Sorry, I can't say that word without being sarcastic.
Epic.
It was clearly just an amazing production and props to the team, man. It was, I mean, if you're going to go out, why not fucking do it like that? You know, hell yeah. Like
fucking hell.
Because like, I feel like, wait, what was I going to say again? I feel like they did put on a good show and it was going out with a bang. And if there was a way that she was going to go out, this was the best way to go out. I completely agree with her creatively and I hope the best for her future endeavors because I would choose the same thing. I would choose to go out with a bang rather than just like fizzle out.
Yeah, absolutely.
Especially if you're not happy with what you're doing, right?
Right.
Like it's inevitable that it's gonna happen. So it was the right move, I think.
It just really now puts into perspective, I'm just like, who's the next one that's gonna go? If there is gonna be another one right?
It's an interesting thing because I feel that because it was so new and so fresh, the idea of people are gonna leave, it was so odd, right? But I guess they can't always just people joining, right? Right. It's going to get to a point where there's going to be as many people leaving as there is joining.
I do, yeah, but there has to be. That's the thing, right? It's like, I do wonder, because Coco was the first Hololive talent to leave Hololive on her own accord, right? Like, I'm just thinking, like, I guess, of we know, right? But like, I'm sure, like, her announcing that she was going to leave probably planted in some of the other talent's heads being like, oh, you can just leave?
You can do that?
You can leave?
You can just quit?
Yeah.
Well, yeah, I think the most interesting thing for me personally about VTubers is like the politics of it all.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
It seems like there is like a lot
especially on the JP side.
Yeah, and it's just really entertaining watching it because everyone's like, no, you can't turn left. You have to turn right.
And everyone's
like freaking out. And it's really,
thousands of people backseating you.
It's very fun watching this kind of stuff, you know, and the rules and all the politics. It's like people turn anime into Game of Thrones sometimes. YouTubers. And it's hella exciting. I love watching it. I'm like a spectator, you know, in that sense. And I think that this does ask the question of, is this going to be a normal thing? Mm. How will it be dealt with? What impact will this have on VTubing as a whole? Who knows?
Yeah.
I'm going to be watching on the sidelines, having a great time.
Because recently there's been a couple of like bigger Niji Sanji VTubers as well that have like left on their own accord. And it's I feel it's like slowly starting to become a thing of like just, especially the bigger creators kind of realizing that, oh, if I stay in a kind of like agency, then I'm kind of limited to what I can do.
You can only be a VTuber, right?
And it's only up until they get to a certain point that they realize like, oh, if I just leave, I have so many more opportunities that I can try out for myself without being like restricted.
I mean, it's like a catch 22, right?
Yeah.
Because I feel like, you know, without saying anything too private, like, you know, I feel like Coco was one of the few who had established herself like outside, you know, and I feel like, especially with how big she is, she can do whatever the hell she wants, be able to establish herself. But I feel like especially with some Hololive VTubers, they're only known for being Hololive VTubers.
True.
Right. Yeah. And it's like a catch 22 because they could leave whenever they want, but if they leave, what would they be saying goodbye to? You know, they basically have to like build themselves up from the ground up again.
Yeah.
And with the VTubing scene being how it is, they can't really build up any other kind of thing that they do outside of Hololive, right? Because that's-
They kind of just be like typecasted, right?
It's the secrecy behind the VTubing and there is a reason for it. But at the same time, if there is a VTuber who does want to talk about their other lives, then they just can't with the platform they have. And they're just going to be known as this Hololive VTuber rather than anything else they may potentially want to be.
Which is
why if we saw someone leave a VTuber agency to become another VTuber, I'd feel like that's like the wrong idea.
Yeah.
Like the whole point is to expand, you know, and do something else.
Yeah.
Otherwise, why did you leave?
Right? Yeah. you just made it harder on yourself, right?
Right. And also like, you know, obviously Hololive is big and there's, you know, there's other agencies and there's just, I mean, God, there's fucking so many now.
Yeah.
What I find interesting now as a content creator is that, you know, in YouTube and Twitch, there's hierarchies, right? Of your size, right? And like with YouTube and Twitch, where you're kind of on your own, you kind of just do your own thing, you do what you want. If you're with an agency, there's kind of expectations of you to perform or do anything, right?
Yeah.
So, you know, when you start bringing in talent and you keep bringing in talent, what happens when you have too many people and the market is oversaturated and it's partially your agency, right?
Yeah.
So what if you have too many VTubers and maybe you're some of the VTubers that aren't doing too well, struggling a little bit? Mm. How do you handle that? Like, what do you do? Do you like just leave it?
That's where I'm interested in
seeing how they handle that. Cause that'll really show what their mindset is
on
how to handle situations.
Well, because I think currently Hololive now has like less than 30, no, around 30, I'd say.
I think there's more than that, right?
If you include EN and IN and ID and the whole
stars.
There's
probably more languages in future.
Yeah. Yeah. Let's guess like probably around like less than 50, I reckon, which is still a lot.
Right.
But then you have agencies like Niji Sanji that have literally hundreds.
Right. And VTubers. Like, you know, if you're an agency where you're like, okay, you know, if we want to keep bringing in new talent, we got to hire more staff. We can't afford to do it because not everyone's pulling in the same numbers. Not everyone can be the number one, obviously. what do? Do you start cutting off talent? If so, how does that look publicly, right?
Like, I mean, I feel like that's a lose-lose, right? Because you can't just cut off talent, because no matter what, if you cut talent off, their fan base is going to fucking make a lot of noise and you don't come out looking good at all.
No.
And I guess, I don't know, it's interesting, but I don't think-
There's just so many problems and challenges that I think will arise.
Mm. Yeah.
Because we haven't seen them yet, because it's so new.
Yeah.
But I think down the line, we're going to be coming into these things, and I'm just interested to see how the fan bases will handle all these things coming out. Because they're going to happen at some point, right?
Yeah, I mean, like, right now, the VTubing scene is kind of like the Wild West.
Yeah, it is.
It's the new thing, and it's just starting to establish itself now. Like, it's only getting to the point now where, you know, we had the massive explosion in 2020, and now we're kind of seeing what the VTubing scene, is going to be really like in 2021 and above. Because, you know, right now Coco leaving, that's a massive creator on the platform, and arguably she, for the longest time, she was the face of Hololive, especially like early 2020. She was
internationally,
she was the face, and now it's kind of like it's becoming a new kind of scene now. So it's interesting. It's going to be interesting to see how the scene develops.
There's just so many interesting things that happen and challenges that will come up in that kind of space as opposed to normal YouTubing and Twitch.
Yeah.
But because we live this job, right? So I'm just fascinated by how a company would deal or how it would tackle some of those challenges.
It's gonna be interesting to see.
Yeah, like, I don't know. That's what I find most interesting about it. Yeah. It's, you know, I just love seeing the scene. It's such an interest. It's like, 'cause this is the first time probably God knows when we'll see this again, where a whole kind of genre has just popped up in very quickly and explodes and is very self-contained. Because normally everything-
Is it self-contained?
I think it's the most self-contained we've seen out of any genre online.
Oh, I think Hololive is obviously definitely very self-contained by design. Mm. But I feel like VTubing as a whole is now kind of like, especially with the amount of VTubers that have popped up on Twitch and every other streaming platform.
Yeah, it's not so much, but I guess it was interesting at the time. I think it's everyone's just doing everything now, but
I think it's still self-contained though, in a sense, because like, you have a lot more like individual VTubers now doing things with other individual VTubers and, you know, VTubers and agencies and stuff like that. But at the end of the day, if you yourself also aren't a VTuber, it's very difficult to do anything with those kinds of people. More difficult than I'd say, you know, like if I wanted to collab with like another YouTuber.
I don't know, right? I think it's just a humor thing really. If you have the same kind of content-ish aimed at the same audience kind of thing, it's doable, I think. I don't know,
Yeah, I mean, I feel like VTubing is just obviously the trends now, but I feel like if anything, if you want to start off streaming or something, or just you're a new content creator, then just by being a VTuber, you're more likely to get noticed than just by like being a normal on-camera streamer.
Sure.
Unfortunately, I don't know why that is.
People like anime now, bro. That's just how it is, isn't it?
People just want to see anime girls and boys, apparently. Yeah. They just hate the real people.
Is there a big male VTuber? I don't think we've seen any big one though.
Actually, the biggest VTuber in Nijisanji is a guy.
Is it really?
Yeah. It's this guy called Kuzuha, who I think has like almost 900K subs.
Oh shit, really?
Yeah, he's really, and he was really interesting as well because he was actually scouted by Nijisanji because he was originally an individual VTuber who gained so much of a massive and dedicated fan base that he got picked up by Nijisanji, and now he's the biggest Nijisanji streamer, and he's essentially the biggest male streamer.
I wonder why I'm never getting recommended clips of him.
Because he's very Japanese.
I get recommended Japanese clips all the time. I'm like, I don't watch this.
But yeah.
Like, stop shoving them down my throat.
I mean, he's really fun. Like I watched a couple of his streams and he's super fun to watch, but it's just really interesting how he managed to stand on top of a very female oriented.
Yeah, because
like, that is interesting.
I don't think we, in English, I don't think there's a big male VTuber.
Which is weird to think because most of the big streamers are male. I mean, male streaming is like right now, at least a male dominated market because you've got like Valkyrie and Pokimane up there in the top 10, but everyone else I think is male, right?
That's messy.
Well, like with VTubers, pretty much I think 90% of the big VTubers are female right now, at least.
Yeah, so, definitely. I mean, like,
I wonder why. Why do you think that is? Like, just throwing ideas out there. Like,
waifus.
Yeah, I think literally waifus. Yeah, people want to watch cute girls than cute boys, right? Yeah. That's just how it is.
You think so? I don't know. I feel like it's too easy to say that. That's like, I don't know. There's got to be a reason. Maybe I've never like I've watched because sometimes I'll just click the VTuber tag on Twitch and I'll browse through. And you know, and I haven't really seen many guys in there that I'm like, oh yeah, it's not like super naturally entertaining. Mm-hmm. I don't know, it's tough.
Because what makes, I don't, this might be getting into a different topic, but what does make a popular streamer? Because
it's tough.
Because what is the audience for male streamers? Is it still mostly males or?
I don't know, I feel, I don't know if Twitch tells me.
It depends on the content, right?
Like, I feel like I have a pretty healthy balance, I think.
Yeah, right?
Most, you know, I don't know.
Can you even look that up on Twitch?
Fuck if I am. Yeah. You probably can.
I know you can on YouTube,
you can. Oh, so okay. I mean, maybe I'll check later and I'll put it on screen. Yeah.
It is weird, now that I think about it, while there are so few bigger male VTubers compared to the females.
I don't want to say like the meme, but is it maybe the fact that if you're a, you know, you would just be a normal male streamer if you were good at it? Would like, is there benefits to being a VTuber as a male over just doing, showing your face if you can?
It's really strange because like, I feel actually like internationally, this idea of like VTubers has very much been created and established through Hololive.
Yeah.
Where like, you know, but like at the end of the day, you have to realize that Hololive is actually the weirder one because they're more of like an idol agency.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
Whereas like Niji Sanji VTubers and like Vishoujo or like even like the individual VTubers, right? They're not idols. They're just streamers.
I wonder if it's the case of like people like, it's going to sound bad, but I think this is true.
Yeah.
I think guys want to watch a guy who they think is their bro.
Yeah.
They think it's their mate. They feel like they can joke with, you know, it's their humor. Yeah. And I think that guys want to watch girls. They're the ideal of their girl that they want to watch.
Yeah, yeah.
You think almost,
no,
right?
I agree with that.
And I think that works perfectly with VTubing because you can give the character you want to play, but you can also put a nice, healthy injection of personality.
Mm. Yeah.
And like, I wonder if that doesn't quite work with guys. But then again, I guess that's the question of, if you're a male VTuber, what's your target demo? Are you trying to be the sexy VTuber? Because I've seen those guys who are trying to be the sexy VTuber and I cringe internally and a lot.
Because
they do that voice like, yeah, okay, I'm a male VTuber. I was saying like that.
Yeah, because I feel like with a lot of male VTubers I've seen. No, I think that's a legit point because I think like with a lot of male VTubers I see and it's kind of like they're trying to take the Hololive kind of model and flip it and gender flip it, right?
So I don't think it works at all.
Yeah, and I think at the end of the day, a lot of the male streamers that are big have like an equal amount of male to female viewers, if not maybe more so male.
Which is really interesting, right? Because again, when I was looking up on Kuzuha, the top streamer for Niji Sanji, his audience is 95% like female.
Yeah. That makes sense.
But it's
also
really
in
weird.
Japan, that is normally like they're very much more willing to buy into that.
Right, yeah, but what's really weird is that his personality does not match that demographic.
Yeah.
His personality is a lot more like gruff and just like straight to the point. He's really like foul-mouthed.
Yeah. That's popular in Japan though.
It is popular in Japan, but like you would think that the standard formula to get a female audience, right, is like, as you said, like the very like type of guys, right?
But then I don't think that it is. I think when you try to be sexy, you're not sexy.
Right.
Yeah.
And also, you know.
Especially when you're in an avatar.
That's for me, you know. Yeah. Maybe because I'm older, right? When I see a guy who's using an anime avatar and he's doing this like edging voice where I'm like, bro. Like literally just imagine a guy in his room in front of like a Dell monitor going, oh yeah. Oh,
in front of his blue Yeti.
Yeah, it's like it's like, you know, I don't want that, you know. But I'm not shitting on anybody, you know. I'm not saying they are out there, but I have seen some that have done it, and I'm just like, oh, for fuck's sake. I think there just hasn't. It's hard because I think if you're the type of personality that it would need to kill it as a male VTuber is also the kind of person who wouldn't give a fuck about showing their face.
Yeah, I feel like if anything, unlike being a female VTuber, being a male VTuber actually makes it harder for you to get noticed.
Yeah, definitely.
I've never really thought about that until now.
It's hard because I'm sure there's going to be tons of male VTubers out there who are like, you are totally wrong. But it's like, well, I think we come from a perspective of just general entertainment and YouTube and live streaming. And we have these kind of, I feel like we've been doing this for a very long time.
Yeah.
And we have kind of, we know what kind of personalities work in certain areas. So I'm not thinking about it. I feel like when you're in the community, you're almost too regurgitative of ideas around you. Mm. You know, you kind of see, you copy everything around you because that's what people do, right? Yeah. You don't try and stand out. But
yeah,
I don't know. It's tough.
It's fascinating.
Because I love, yeah, it's so interesting because that's the thing is that I feel like no one's really figured it out yet in English at least. I'm sure someone's going to comment and be like, no, but what about this guy? I'm like, if they'd
we
done
don't
it,
know every
if they'd have done it, they'd, you know, if they're killing it really, they'll probably be high up, you know? Yeah, if they're not right now, they will be soon. I'll eat my words. You
the
know
fact
what I mean?
That like, we can't immediately say a name is, I think, telling.
It's like super big, you know? Yeah, like, yeah. I'm talking like
I obviously do know male VTubers.
Yeah, same.
But none of them are pulling in numbers.
Yeah, none of them are pulling in the numbers that female VTubers are, or anywhere close from what I've seen.
No.
I mean, all the big agencies, all the big groups, the main focus is the female VTubers. And like the male VTubers, there are like, for example, Holostars, but that always seems like tacked on.
And
you know what I mean?
Holostars doesn't really pull in that much compared to the girls.
It really
doesn't.
Yeah,
it really doesn't, unfortunately, for whatever reason.
I feel it's because again, like that's on Hololive for not promoting Holostars as much as Hololive, right?
But I also just think that like they don't know, like it's so difficult. I think it is genuinely very difficult to get the right personality.
It's also difficult to like really nail down like a target demographic, especially if you're a guy, like because you do have so many avenues, unlike a lot of female VTubers where it's like your target demographic is very obvious.
Yeah, yeah. I also want to say that we're not trying to sit here and argue that it's easy to be a female VTuber. I think it's just like, I don't think the right personality is like kind of figured it out yet. I think it's the same, but it's, you know, it's
I think the important thing is that you can't just take what works for a female VTuber, put it in a male avatar 100%. And expect it to produce the same results. I think it is a very different field. And there is a discussion there about why, you know, it's the same with female streamers as well. There's a reason I think that, you know, a lot of the top streamers right now are males, you know, and that's just the way things are right now. And I think it's kind of the reverse for VTubers, if anything.
Yeah.
Never really thought about it until
now. It's fascinating.
Yeah.
That's what I mean. This is what the stuff that I wake up at middle of the night thinking about, you know?
Like, in a cold sweat.
This is why, again, like I don't really watch, I'm not like an avid watcher of anyone. I just kind of like watch channels here and there, I'll go on Twitch and I've watched a lot of the small VTubers on Twitch. I'll just flick between them at night, watch 5 minutes. All right, I've seen enough. Watch 5 minutes. All right, seen enough. Just because I like seeing what everyone's doing, you know? Mm-hmm. I'm just trying to find something out there that's really interesting.
Mm. Yeah.
And again, I think because the scene is so young right now, like it's got all of these really interesting problems that like haven't been figured out yet. Whereas YouTube and Twitch have been gamified to death.
Mm. Yeah.
Like we can probably tell you who's going to be good and who isn't and who's going to be able to figure stuff out. You know what I mean? Like it's super interesting and I find it so fascinating. And I love, because I'm obsessed with YouTube, obsessed with Twitch. I love everything about content creation and the fact that I get to experience something brand new kind of pop up and get to like watch it unfold is like the most fun I've had in forever. Because I just like, YouTube, man.
That's why I've just been really enjoying like kind of watching around all these like it's different fun, kinds of man. VTubers. Because it's just like, it's just, for the longest time, I always just thought VTubing equals Hololive. When now I know that's completely not the case. There are so many variants out there that are just completely different to what Hololive is doing.
Yeah, when I find a guy who I think is small and is about to blow up and kill it, VTuber, I'll write it down. I'll let you know.
Yeah, I told you so. Promote it.
But right now, I don't think there's anyone who's kind of got the right formula that's going to take off.
Yeah.
Everyone's still trying to figure out their own thing.
I think so. I think everyone's kind of scrambling to see what's going to work.
I feel like the male VTubing scene, they were waiting for that first big creator that everyone's going to follow. Because it only takes one, right?
The ninja male VTubers. I've not seen enough movement.
Yeah, because like Hololive figured out the perfect formula for female VTubers and everyone.
Now that they're like, write that down, do it again in the more languages.
Yeah,
and then it worked. And now VTubing's fucking massive for females. And then I feel like it's going to take that first massive male creator on the same level as Hololive or like other big female creators that's going to be like, okay, this is what works. Everyone copy this guy.
That's how it always is, right?
This is
what works, copy it. But then that's why I feel like it's not really going anywhere right now, just because everyone's just copying everyone who isn't seeing massive success.
Yeah.
So it's interesting.
It's that meme of like the artists are giving $50 to the same artist just going around.
That's what YouTube and Twitch is. Like it's just everyone's iterating on each other and copying. And that's how it is. And there's one person
who's like, how about I
don't someone, do that? Someone always has that one idea that just changes the system.
Yeah. But then eventually that original person will just set a trend and then that trend will become the norm. Yeah.
And then you build on that trend and you keep building on that trend.
And then the new system is created.
Yeah, it's just like the clickbait law, right? Like clickbait evolves. It's so interesting watching how clickbait evolves on YouTube, because then there's this like anti-clickbait meta that I always see pop up that eventually becomes the clickbait itself. True. Like I remember like ages ago before ProZD popularized the, hey, I don't give a shit about clickbait. It's just gonna be my face and just like a very basic title with like no caps or whatever. And then that just became a whole genre in itself.
Because a video with no clickbait and a shit ton of views is clickbait.
Yeah,
exactly, because you're curious, how did this get views? Something's going on here, right? Like, if you saw a video that had one of those like Indian Facebook post levels of editing that had like 10 million views, you'd click on that shit. Cause you're like, how the fuck does this have 10 million views?
Yeah, absolutely.
And then that's how it works.
That reminds me of the shit you were showing me last Thursday.
Yeah, I was showing Gon. Have you seen a Darman?
Oh yeah.
I was showing God Darman. And also,
I don't get it.
I don't get it. How is this got so many views?
Gon isn't into the YouTubes as I am. So there's a channel called Darman.
Yeah.
And I don't even know how to describe it. What is he? He does these, and I swear it's so popular. Everyone knows about it. He does these videos where it's basically like a message.
It's like motivational speech, right?
There'll be one where it's like, gold digger gets exposed, or actor quits because he got hate comment. Yeah. And it'll basically be like, all right, this guy gets a hate comment online, and then Darman comes in with a piece of motivational advice that flips it all on its head, and the bullies feel like shit. And the guy who was being bullied gets a Lamborghini, succeeds in life. And it's always that. It's like the most stereotypical, man gets bullied or someone does bad thing, gets the comeuppance for the bad thing, and the person who did wrong gets done right. It's always how it is.
Like his videos just hit in like the perfect, or just—
it's literally not Facebook
not
videos.
Not the perfect, I mean, it is Facebook videos, but it's even— It hits that uncanny valley, right? Where it's just so weird to watch one of these videos and just think it's the most like bare bones message that you can present in a video, right? And the way I thought of it watching these videos that were getting like tens of millions of views, by the way, it's like a /that really happens post in every video, because every video ends with "and then everyone claps."
Yeah.
You know, that's
What was the dude again on Facebook? Prince E?
Prince
EA. He kind of did a similar thing where he'd do like these like beat poetry, like too deep for you, like life lessons. And I'm just like, no one lives like this.
And then
this.
He did like videos where he's like, depression is just sadness. Stop being sad. He did like videos like that. And
he was like, depression is like this TV remote. It comes, then it goes.
Yeah.
It comes, then it goes. Just
turn it off.
Yeah.
It's terrible. And then, and I showed Gon. I'm like, this guy gets like 30 million views a video.
Yeah, it's
and
nuts.
He uploads daily.
Yeah.
Yeah, which like respect to him and his production crew, because the videos are like very well shot.
Oh yeah, they're very well
produced. And they—
well, he should be, because he's probably making fucking $50 million a year on ad rev alone.
Yeah, yeah. And you got like different, you know, you got so many different actors playing these parts as well. So you got like a proper crew pumping these videos out. And I just think like, you know, it's so weird because there's so few times where I watch a video and I watch a trend on YouTube and I'm just like, I don't get it. I don't get it. Like how is this doing this well? Cause sometimes you see a video and you're like, okay, this isn't my type of content, but I can see why it's doing well.
Yeah.
But then Connor shows me this and it's like the hottest fucking trend right now, getting fucking blowing everyone out in terms of views. And I'm just like, how?
I don't know. I mean, that's also just really funny, but—
I mean, I think it definitely also helps the fact that there are a lot of YouTubers out there like poking the shit out
of it. Oh yeah, there's so many YouTubers mocking it.
Yeah, so like that in and of itself is just free promotion, right? And people, I guarantee there's lots of people like hate watching this shit as well.
It's so preachy that you can't help but watch it and think, fucking hell, like—
I'm like, it ain't that deep, bro. It really ain't that deep.
It's like I've fucking seen Disney movies less preachy or cheesy than this, right? Like it's fascinating. I found it like fascinating seeing that this was the hot thing that's going on right now.
And I also showed him Arcade Craniacs, if you don't know what that is. Do you know what that is?
No, what's that?
It's the guys that do the 3 AM Among Us BTS meal video.
What?
It's honestly impossible.
That doesn't sound like a real video.
Well, the point is that they're basically this channel that parodies kid videos, the 3 AM videos
for
literal like 5-year-olds, but including like adult jokes that kids wouldn't get, but also mocking and parodying the style. It's really like, it's the most internet humor thing I've ever watched. And okay. It's so funny.
Okay.
It's so good. I can't even explain it. It's just like, just watch it and you'll see. Like,
what's the channel called?
Arcade Craniacs.
Arcade Craniacs.
Yeah, and like they just do a thing where it's like, oh, I went to get the BTS meal and then at 3 a.m. and then BTS Jimin was delivered to my door or something. And he like pronounced the name horribly or something.
That's already funny.
And then he's like, what is this? And he drinks the Sprite and he's like, it's BTS sweat. I know, I was at the concert and it tastes like their sweat. And it's just like, what is this?
I need to watch this.
It's insane. Like it's so popular right now on YouTube, but it's so funny.
What's going on with YouTube recently?
It's just so, it's so insane. It's so
obscure now.
It's so good though. I love where it's going. It's getting so meta. Like everything is so meta right now. Yeah. I love it. It's so funny. If you haven't checked it out, I kind of think you have to watch a lot of YouTube to enjoy it because it's a parody on shit YouTube that adults wouldn't watch, but you would only know if you watch videos that roasted the kids' content anyway.
Yeah. Or you've seen the memes of it.
Yeah, it requires like four layers of YouTube knowledge to enjoy it. But if you watch a shit ton of YouTube, you might enjoy it. Okay. Check it out. It's a fever dream anyway.
Yeah.
It's very funny.
I think all of what we've discussed right now has just been a fever dream to me.
Well, we talk a lot about YouTube, but it's because, I mean, we live it, we watch it so much. It's so relevant.
You know, when you showed me Darman, I ended up staying up like drunk till 4 a.m. watching his videos. Being like, what is going on?
Why did you watch them?
I don't know.
Where was my invite? That sounds like an amazing time.
You were away.
Time.
Yeah, you were away.
Damn
you...
it.
it was after we had a little celebration to open this office.
And then we
went back and I was like, let me show you Darman.
I just like my drunk 4 a.m. mind just like could not comprehend what I was watching because it was a fucking fever dream for me.
Yeah.
Watch one Darman video because I can't. It's so hard to explain what makes it weird.
I'll give you a quick run through of Darman video right now. I'll do one. Okay. It's like, all right, hi, I am cheating wife. Hi, I am husband with failing business. Oh, okay. Damn, you're so gross. Poor husband, get away from me. I'm going to cheat on you with someone. She cheats. And then, wow, my business is now succeeding. Cheating wife wants to come back and sleep with him again. But he's like, no, no, I'm successful now and happy in a relationship. Moral of the story, don't cheat on your husband who is working hard and being nice. That's it.
Then everyone clapped.
It's not even deep. It's just common sense.
it's just watch it. It's funny. It's really funny.
Oh my God.
Yeah,
I mean, I saw one about like-
Don't watch it alone. Get a bunch of your friends, have a few beers, and then enjoy the nature of it. It's fun. It's just so good.
Yeah, I think I saw one that was like against someone being racist towards an Asian dad trying to open a nail salon or something like that.
Right.
And I think the moral of the story is, don't be racist. And I was just like, great.
I like the idea that somebody out there who is susceptible to a video changing their whole view on racism, that they just watch this and they're like, shit, I've been racist this whole time. I can't believe this. You know?
I should go and apologize to the two Asians I know in my life.
You know, and it's like, it's fine, but it's like, you know, you're out here hustling. I get it. You know, that's easy to make money off of. Do it. Fuck it. But it's not going to change anyone's mind.
I mean, you know, I appreciate the sentiment because obviously, you know, racism is
bad.
You know, in case you didn't know.
if you didn't know, you should watch a YouTuber called Darman.
Yeah. Yeah, but I was racist before Darman. Like every white man, I was racist.
You know, I was going to cheat on my, you know, boyfriend that was trying hard to succeed in his business until I
opened a fortune cookie.
until I saw a Darman video.
It's literally the fortune cookies of YouTube.
I was a gold digger before I met Darman. Yeah. Now I'm no longer a gold digger and I appreciate everything in life.
Yeah, speaking about like the reason why you weren't there to share our Darman watch sesh, Joey.
Big sad.
So I heard you went to Nintendo World.
What? Oh shit, yeah, you did.
How did you know? Is it possibly the Nintendo World show? Yeah.
Yeah, you look like a fucking staff member, Joey. Can I help you? Can I?
Dude, okay.
Forgot to ask you about that.
Can I just say the Nintendo World staff like uniforms?
Yeah.
They're not uniforms. That's drip. Like it literally looks so fucking cool. I was like, really? I was like, I want that for merch. Fuck these other, even though I bought this. Fuck these other shirts. It's like, I want what they're wearing.
Fuck you, but I'm gonna buy them.
So Aki and I went to USJ, Universal Studios Japan, and there's Nintendo World there for our anniversary.
Very
popular. And I'd never been to USJ before. In fact, I very much despise amusement parks.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh. Joey doesn't like amusement parks.
I don't like amusement parks.
I like thrill ride amusement parks.
Really? Yeah. I like roller coasters.
Oh, I'm the complete opposite. I hate roller coasters.
What? Yeah. Why? And why do you hate fun?
And what's I think that's why I don't like amusement parks, because a lot of amusement parks are very focused on like roller coasters and like thrill
rides.
That's
the best part.
That's literally the best part.
That's literally the reason.
What do you hate about them? Why do you hate fun?
I don't hate fun because they're not fun.
How are they not fun?
I don't think roller coasters are fun at all.
What?
I'm just like, why?
Are you scared of them?
Yes.
Okay.
I'm scared of them, but also B, I'm like, why do I have to wait in line for 2 hours to enjoy a ride that lasts
it's
5 minutes?
It's an experience that you'll never get.
No, it's an experience I can get. In fact, it's an experience I don't want to get.
I think it's amazing.
Look, I will fully buy the fact that I'm very much a pussy when it comes to roller coasters, but-
Your words, not mine.
Okay. But it's fine. I will live with that, but- So we went to Nintendo World because it opened up in, what was it, like February of this year?
Yeah.
It was a couple of months ago, but obviously it was fucked for a little bit because-
So like finna open during pandemic.
Yeah. I'm going to open during pandemic and then no one came obviously. So it was fucked for a few months, but I think like a month or two ago, they like reopened to the public. So we were like, well, fuck it, let's go. Like we can go during the press event. Let's go. I'm a Nintendo boy. I'm a gamer boy.
I like Nintendo.
You're a gamer girl. I'm a gamer boy.
I've played a video game in my life.
I know Mario. So we went. Dead ass was probably the most fun I've ever had in an amusement park.
Really?
It was so fun. So first of all, they absolutely nailed the aesthetic. Oh, people talk about-
That was probably the thing that looked amazing.
It looks amazing, like in the promotional videos. It looks 100 times more impressive when you're there in real life.
Wow. Was it sunny when you went?
It wasn't. We were kind of in the middle of a typhoon.
And it still looked good?
It still looked amazing.
Because all the promotional pictures are like in like the best lighting in existence.
Yeah.
I bet it would look and feel amazing in clouds because that's what it's like in the game.
Yeah.
If it was fucking pouring it down, you'd be like-
I mean, okay. I think the weather was on our side because the weather like subsided like kind of halfway through the day.
Okay.
Right.
But when we were there, it was like pouring quite a bit. But even in the rain, like I was like, I thought they had just oversaturated the trailer footage. Mm-hmm. So it looked more impressive. I was like, oh, they didn't oversaturate this at all. They didn't color correct this at all. This looks just as good as in the trailer footage.
Okay.
And it's really impressive because the scale of it is so massive looking.
Yeah.
Like, because like you see like the little like kind of mounds in like the background, right? And you think, oh, that must be like really tiny. They're fucking huge.
Yeah.
They're buildings that you can like walk into. And I was just gonna say like, I think the one thing that I really enjoyed about it is the fact that, I mean, there's only like two rides, mm-hmm. like if three.
That's what I was kind of like sad about. Is that there was only two rides and one of them was like a car that takes you around.
I was like,
wow, they really put all the budget into the set design.
Yeah, huh? if you're into like amusement parks because of like roller coasters and stuff that, I don't think that's really the place for you. Yeah. Luckily, it's in USJ, so there's plenty of roller coasters in USJ. But like, I mean,
perfect for you though, right?
Perfect for me.
Probably why you enjoyed it so much.
I mean, I'm a fucking Nintendo boy through and through.
Yeah,
and there were no real like roller coasters type of thing or anything. But I think the thing that impressed me the most is the fact that you can buy these like kind of, I don't even know what they are. They're like these electronic watches, essentially, that you can wrap around, and it essentially connects to the entirety of Nintendo World and makes the entire park interactive.
Wait, how big's the
park? Damn, okay.
Yeah.
How big is the park?
I wanna say,
How long can you see everything in? Like an hour?
Oh yeah, easily in an hour.
Okay.
See, but the thing is, even though the space isn't big, it's so jam-packed with shit that you can do. Like literally, there isn't a single piece of wasted space. Like this was engineered to shit where it's like, we got to fill every little space up with something to do. And like, I feel like the electronic bands that you have to buy at like 3000 yen or something, like it was like bucks. 30 bucks. But I think if you don't buy that, you're probably missing out on about 70% of the park.
So what does it allow you to do?
So the bands, what they do is there are like, so there's an app that connects to the band. Mm-hmm. And that app, when you look at it, it gives you like a
download
list.
The app.
So you download the app.
Oh god, that's so annoying.
Yeah, I mean, it's a little bit annoying.
I guess if you're a tourist though, watch out for that. Maybe pre-download the app.
Yeah. Honestly, he was showing me the app earlier. It fucking looks incredible.
I can show it to you. So yeah, you download the app and then you go to the Super Nintendo World and then it loads up essentially. And you get, so basically there are these like stamps that you can get for achievements that you unlock by interacting in Super Nintendo World.
So you're literally just playing Achievement Hunter this theme park.
I'm literally getting Xbox achievements. Except instead of Xbox, then Nintendo.
I'm gaming.
bruh, you have you 100% in Nintendo world? Because I have.
But like, what's kind of big brain about it?
Dude, that looks
it?
So clean, honestly. Yeah,
it is clean. And like, there's like an interactive map as well that shows you like all of the locations been to.
I fuck with that. That's yeah. Cool.
So you know exactly like which parts of the world you haven't explored yet or haven't actually interacted with.
That looks so good.
And like, it's honestly like the band is half the experience because there's a couple of rides in Nintendo world that you can't even access if you don't have the band.
Oh. That's kind of shitty though, that you pay full price for the ticket and then you got to pay $30 to get that.
I thought so too, but then the actual amount of experience that you can get on top if you do pay for the $30 is, I think it's completely worth it. And it's also good as well. It's also good as well because there's so much, it adds replay value to actually going back and like doing achievements and like getting the best scores and all that kind of stuff. And like, if you go around with like a bunch of friends, like I went around with Aki and we were like trying to fucking like, out one up each other in terms of like achievements and all that kind of stuff. Like that is half the fun.
Trash Day Special.
Oh, dude, USJ hit us up.
Just realized that Nintendo really just added microtransactions to like a real life theme park.
They really did. But like, I don't know. I thought it was fucking big brain. And like you can eat, if you're, especially if you like love anything Nintendo and you're like fully ready to like immerse yourself in the actual park.
Well, it's like Mario Land, right? Is it?
Yeah. Then if you're fully ready to immerse yourself in the land, like completely, and just forget about the fact that like, you know, this is essentially one big microtransaction. if you live the dream, if you live the dream like you do at any amusement park, then it is the most fun.
So how long did you spend in there?
We spent about like 5 or 6 hours in there, but I could easily spend a whole day in there. Well, like we spent about like maybe 3/4 of the day there because I wanted to like go around to the other parts of USJ because I'd never been before. So we went to like Harry Potter World and like Jurassic Park World and all that kind of stuff that's there as well. And that's the good thing, right? Is that like, you know, you can spend like a decent amount of time there, but if you get bored, just pop on over to Harry Potter World, which is like literally a 2-minute walk from Nintendo World, right? But yeah, it was super fucking fun.
I mean, I want to go at some point. Yeah. I haven't been in a rush to go because I know that eventually when people come to visit, they're going to be like, I want to go there. And I'm let's go.
Yeah,
so
definitely.
I don't want to go there like 5 times and have to take someone.
Yeah.
Again. Like, all right, let's go again.
How are the crowds there?
The right crowds now? It was like decently crowded. I think right now USJ is really banking off Nintendo World because I think the majority of the park was at Nintendo World. I mean, rightfully so, it is the newest thing. And they're chilling the fuck out of Nintendo stuff even outside of Nintendo World. But I mean, when I went there, totally made sense as to why that was the case. Cause it was, I was like, damn, this is like completely different level of upgrade to like any other world out there.
I want to go.
I want to go as well. And I want to go before the country fully opens up and you get the rush.
You know, it's going to be hell when there's tourists.
Yeah.
Oh, dude, tourists are going to be flooding.
Because you probably enjoyed it because there was no one there. Because like, imagine it, you're at Nintendo World, you're like, whoa, what secrets can I see? And then there's just a line for every single thing. And like every single thing you got to bump or use.
Yeah, we only had to wait like max 15 minutes. For each ride.
Which is very good for an amusement park.
Which is really good for USJ,
As we know, the worst thing about amusement park are the crowds and the lines, right?
Because like, I think they also
I like a good queue. I like a good wait.
I don't.
That's the British coming out on you,
it
man.
It is, I like a good queue. I don't mind waiting.
Because I think they also structured it so that like, they were anticipating the massive amount of lines. Because like the VR Mario Kart, for example, which is easily the best ride that they have there.
Well, I did VR Mario Kart with you in Ikebukuro.
At VR Park,
is it the same thing?
Completely different.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So VR Mario Kart in VR Park in Ikebukuro used to be in Shinjuku.
Yeah.
Was like, you're in like a still cart and you have the VR goggles on and you have like the glove on that you can like use to grab items and stuff.
Yeah, but
like
the car had hydraulics in it. So you would like, when you did forward, it would turn. Like
But this time around in Nintendo World, the car itself is also moving. So it's like moving on a rail.
And then when you move it, does it move?
And when you move it, it moves. And you have the VR goggles on so that everything around you now is basically a hologram.
It's VR go-kart?
VR go-karting, essentially. Yeah.
That sounds fun.
And
I'm down.
It's hectic, dude. It's super fucking hectic. But like that, obviously that one I think is going to be the most popular. Yeah. But I think they perfectly planned for it as well because from the entrance of you have to enter Bowser's Castle to get to it. Mm-hmm. So like the front of it looks like Bowser's Castle. Right, and like the interior and everything is completely perfectly modeled after Bowser's Castle. So you like go up the stairs and there's a giant Bowser statue. And that's all part of the line.
Yeah.
And you walk past and it's like all the Mario Kart like trophies all stacked up and like in order. And like they clearly anticipated for there to be a lot of people. So they were like, we got to make waiting in line entertaining.
I mean, that's what like Disney always did so well. Yeah. I don't really like Disney. The theming was on point, right?
Yeah,
like,
exactly. Yeah. I thought so Disney's well. Theming was on point, but then Nintendo was like, let me one up that for a second. Let me one up.
It's a lot easier, right? When you have a smaller contained land work with. So yeah, but I mean, I do want to go. I will go at some point. Yeah. I don't know fucking
the only thing that would one up that is if they added other Nintendo franchises.
Yeah,
like, and they're like kind of expanded. Because right now it's only really the Mario universe.
Yeah.
But if they added like Zelda Kirby stuff or like any of that.
I do wonder if this was like a thing that Nintendo wanted to do or Universal was like, come on Nintendo, we got a little
I have a feeling this is kind of like a trial run for Nintendo, where they were like, if we open up like a fully dedicated Nintendo world where there's like different worlds for different franchises, mm-hmm. we don't want it to completely fuck up. So let's just like borrow USJ for a second and be like, can we like test it out with like one small segment?
Yeah.
And if it does well, then maybe down the line, we'll make like an actual fully dedicated
Nintendo world. Because they could do a Nintendo world. Like easy, that actually easy, had easy. Like, you know.
They have enough franchises.
With the amount of money they made during the pandemic, especially dude, like they could easily open up their own world if they wanted to.
I mean, just think of all the properties they have. I'm like, all right, well you've got like everything covered. Like you can do any ride, any excuse.
Anything.
You know what I mean? Like everything's covered. Why haven't they done this already?
Come on, Nintendo.
I mean, Nintendo Land, from what the sounds of it, sounds really fucking good and really fun already. Yeah. So imagine that on like a full scale theme park.
Yeah.
And maybe Joey will have an amusement park that you actually enjoy.
Yeah.
Right?
Because I mean, honestly, like that was probably the most fun I've had in an amusement park ever.
What food do they have there?
Oh yeah, so they have Toad's Cafeteria.
Okay. Okay. What do they sell at Toad's Cafeteria? Huh?
At Toad's Cafeteria, they sell, the food there was actually pretty decent. Not the best themed food I've had. Cause I've been to like a lot of
Does it look like Mario characters?
So one of them was this like tiramisu that was shaped after the like question block. So there's a tiramisu shaped like question block. There's also like a mushroom soup, but like the container is actually like the red mushroom.
So
open up the red mushroom cap and like there's mushroom soup on the inside.
I like that. I like it when the thing is like the design of the character or whatever they're trying to do is not intrusive to the flavor of the food.
Right.
It really pisses me off when they do that shit at Disneyland or when they like make shit into like smiley faces with my food. And I'm listen, I don't care about my food being a smiley face. Don't fucking do that. I don't want to feel like I'm two.
Yeah.
Like, I don't give a shit at your theming. Yeah. I don't want you to draw a smiley thing on my steak.
Yeah,
it's a fucking steak. Don't
I mean, obviously, I feel obviously like Nintendo World was definitely aimed more towards like younger children.
No, it's in a lot of towards sense. Me.
But
I'm adult, I don't like it.
But
fuck children.
I feel like they added so many elements that like adults could also easily enjoy.
Right.
I mean, I fucking enjoyed
it. My mom would never buy me the food anyway when I was a kid, so it didn't matter. She'd bring the food. She's like, you're not having theme park food? It's ridiculously expensive, Connor, no way.
It was a bit expensive, but you know, as a first time experience, I think we had to try it. And it was, again.
It's like cinema popcorn,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, it wasn't the best experience I've had at a themed like cafe or anything, but pretty decent.
I don't know if it's still there, but in the UK, and like the best, my favorite theme park, they had like Alton Towers.
Yeah.
Great one. They had a restaurant that was like, I don't know, like $8 all you can eat pizza.
Oh shit.
And I was like, yo, let's go to the theme park. What, for the rides?
No, for the pizza.
All you can eat pizza,
oh,
bro.
Fuck yeah, dude.
And it was great. Cause you know, you could give vomit it all off.
Meanwhile, you go to Disneyland. It's like, would you like a slice of pizza? $8, please.
That's the thing, man. I didn't think I would appreciate it that much until I was given all you can eat pizza for like $8. And I was like, it wasn't great pizza, but it was all you can eat.
Yeah,
so, I mean, it doesn't matter.
So it counts.
And my life was like, this is the best theme park. Fuck the rides, fuck the theming. All you can eat pizza.
It's, I mean, true.
If you put that at a theme park, it automatically goes up.
That just
a
becomes
star
the best
rating.
Establishment, doesn't it?
Yeah, you go to Mario World, they're like, unlimited tiramisu. Just normal tiramisu. We just got it from somewhere. I'm like, okay, shit. Okay, now we're playing.
Fuck,
okay, fuck.
Just give me food. Just give me food.
Just play the Mario theme in the background. I'll feel like it's
just
themed,
yeah, there's just something so nice when you go to the theme park and for 1 minute, they're not trying to rip you off.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Like,
really? I feel the only thing about Nintendo World that I was like, oh, that's a bit weird, was a Toad speaking Japanese.
Oh, really?
What does that sound like?
Because when you go into Toad's Cafeteria, there's like on like a projection screen, there's like Toad like in the kitchen, like preparing food and stuff.
Yeah.
And he like notices you coming in and he's like,
well, yeah, he only
hey, like kind of thing, but in Japanese. And I'm just like, that's weird. Don't talk.
Yeah, in Japanese games, he They use the English, well, the what it's barely English, but they're recording.
Yeah. Yeah. But they use like the like type of voice. Yeah. But then right. the theme park, they can't get away with just a kid. He's just like, yeah, konnichiwa. And I'm just like, oh, that's weird. Just go and then just be with it. It's really fucking bizarre.
Eat my fucking head. drink out of my head, please. My head is your communion.
Like, what the fuck, Toad?
Yeah, that was the only part where I was like, because like same thing happened in Harry Potter World, because we went to like one of the rides at Harry Potter World is that you go into the Hogwarts and it's like a kind of 4D interactive, like it feels like you're on a broom and going through Harry Potter and stuff like that. And it's really fucking cool and intense.
Yeah.
Only thing that threw me off is Daniel Radcliffe speaking Japanese.
Are you speaking Japanese?
Everyone was speaking Japanese.
Do they have like a British Japanese accent?
No, it was just literally just like, they just grabbed a random like anime voice actor and then I was like, yeah, Boku Hari. I was just like, this is weird. Daniel, what happened to you, bro?
It's like an anime dub of-
What was the best line that he whipped out?
The best line? It was just like when you, there's a scene where you like go like fight through all the Dementors and he's like, I think in the English version, you can actually see Daniel Radcliffe mouthing like, wow, that was a close one, wasn't it? Or something like that. But in the Japanese one, he was like, abrakatta ne. I'm just like, oh, Daniel, why? Why were they masking my boy
You said the English spells?
What do you mean? It's the English spells, but said in Japanese.
What is it?
So it's like in katakana.
Yeah, yeah. So it's like, it's not like Wingardium Leviosa. It's like Wingardium Leviosa.
I don't know why it's so funny.
Yeah.
Foreign people trying to speak English. Very funny. I know, very funny.
Yeah.
Yeah. But overall, Nintendo World.
Out of 10?
Like solid 9, I reckon.
9 out of 10, really makes you feel like Mario.
Wait, how much was that t-shirt? I must know.
How much was this one?
Yeah.
This one was 3,500 yen.
It's not too bad. I was expecting it to be like $50. I was like,
I mean, there were like $50 ones as well, yeah.
Really? What were they? Like, they better be designer Gucci.
Okay, one of them I actually bought it because it looked really cool because it was at the, it was next to Bowser's Castle. And there was like a, they themed the merch store next to the VR Mario Kart thing as like it looking like the inside of like a Mario Kart garage. So they had like all of the, there was one shirt that I bought that had like, you know, like in a lot of like car racing, like jackets that have like all the patches of like all the sponsors.
Oh, that sounds cool.
But it was a shirt and all the patches were like Mario themed.
Mm-hmm.
So like that was really cool. And I was like, ooh, $55. Fuck it, I'll take it.
I would.
Yeah, sometimes for me, it's like, it's not about the price. It's like, does it look cool? And is it a thing that I can only get here?
Man.
I'll probably fucking get it.
Man, 12 year old
me would've fucking why lost. They can hike up the price, right?
Exactly.
Exclusivity.
And I'm like, take my money, Nintendo. You've been taking my money for 26 years now. I'm not gonna be mad.
What do you think is the best part of the park that you enjoyed?
I think again, it's the fact that like, buying like the electronic bracelet and
the microtransaction.
Yeah, it's legit the fact that they made literally every single aspect of the park interactive in some way.
I can't wait for that.
Cause like there's like all these like question blocks that are just randomly lying around and you can punch it and it makes like the coin sound and then the coins get added to your bracelet.
Yeah. Man, it's just, imagine you rock up with a family of six and then they're like, you have to pay an extra 180. What? That'd be so sad though. I wish they would include it in the ticket. Well, I assume maybe, what, can you buy a ticket?
You can buy it, with the ticket, yeah. Yeah, that'd be cool. But like, we didn't know about it, so we were just like, oh, this is an option.
Download the app before you go as well.
Can't wait for the Nintendo World speedrunners to get going.
we need a Nintendo World any percent.
Yeah, Nintendo World any percent. I'll fucking do that.
I'm gonna try and go for the record tonight.
Yeah.
And time, go.
Yeah.
All right, well, I guess, that's it for today. I don't really have anything else to talk about.
No. We can talk about one other thing though.
What?
Beautiful our patrons.
Yeah, course, we can.
Hell yeah.
Shout out to, was it Grant Gaylord or something? Was it one of the names?
Grant Gaylord.
Grant Gaylord.
Was it Grant Gaylord?
Well, I wonder if he's on the list somewhere. Yeah. He might
somewhere
be.
Here maybe.
For the most epic name of all time.
Yeah, absolutely.
But thank you to the patrons for making it possible. And again, for funding this brand new set. Wonderful.
Yeah, we love how you guys are loving it because we enjoy it. And we're not going to change, so.
Yes.
Yeah, boohoo. Anyway.
Why are you being mean to our viewers, Joe?
I'm not being mean. I'm not. But yeah, if you guys want to support us, then go over to our Patreon, patreon.com/trashtaste. Also, follow us on Twitter, send us your memes on the subreddit, and if you hate our faces, go listen to us on Spotify.
And hopefully you enjoyed this timely episode of Trash Taste where we talk about current topics, which should have just happened last week. Enjoy it, because this is going to be the last time it happens for a while. We are looking to build up our reserve again.
Only diamond hand here. Only diamond hands with Trash's episode. We're holding.
Yeah, I guess that's everything, right?
Yeah. Bye.
We'll see you guys next time. Bye-bye.